Okay, hello, hello, hello. Let's start with our discussion. Dito tayo ngayon sa second lecture video natin for the second semester kung saan yung ating topic will be, of course, sa PFRS na tayo, starting with PFRS 5. Now, as you can see, sa PFRS 5 tayo nag-start, di ba? Kasi yung last lecture video natin, nag-end tayo sa PFRS 3. So, nag-jump tayo to PFRS 5. Bakit? Kasi yung PFRS 4, diba? Yung PFRS 4 was, ano, insurance contract kung saan na-revise na siya. Oo, naging PFRS 17 na siya. So, yun. Kaya, wala nang PFRS 4 kasi na-revise na siya. Dito tayo ngayon sa PFRS 5, which is non-current assets held for sale and discontinued operations. So, anong learning objectives natin for this topic? Describe daw the criteria for held for sale classification. Pangalawa, state the initial and subsequent measurement of held for sale assets. And lastly, state daw natin the presentation requirements of a discontinued operation. Na itong ano, PFRS 5, isa to sa mga madadaling topic sa FAR. Ngayon, what's the core principle? So, sabi ni PFRS 5, a non-current asset, kasi from the name itself, di ba? Non-current asset held for sale. So, ano to? A non-current asset daw is presented in the classified statement of financial positions, sa balance sheet natin yan, as a current asset. Whoa! Ano yan? Akala ko ba sir, non-current siya? Bakit presented siya as current asset? Malalaman natin later on. As current asset only when it qualifies to be ano, classified as held for sale in accordance with PFRS 5. So, kahit na non-current yan, ika-classify natin siya sa current asset. Oo, yung pagiging non-current niya is only by name. Oo, pero yung nature niya is current asset. Kung saan, pag na-check niya lahat ng qualifications as held for sale in accordance with PFRS 5, yun. Current asset sa statement of financial position natin sa balance sheet. So, yung scope ng PFRS 5 are the following. Kung saan, mga non-current asset. Sir, medyo nahihilo kami. Next slide, malaman natin bakit kinoconsider siya as current. So ito, yung mga underlang sa scope ng PFRS 5, yung mga non-current asset na property, plant and equipment, investment property that is measured under the cost model. Yan, pag-usapan natin yung mga topics ito sa previous lecture videos. Diba? Investment in associate or subsidiary or joint ventures and intangible assets. Ito, na daanan natin ito sila. Now, a non-current asset, diba, or a disposal group, basically, pag disposal group yan, combination yan naman non-current asset, or disposal group, is classified as held for sale or held for distribution to owners if its carrying amount will be recovered principally through a sale transaction rather than to continuing use. So, yan. Meron kang non-current asset. Diba? Meron kang non-current asset. Kung saan, yung ending niya, yung end ng life niya, will be depend, dalawang path sa meron. Yung unang path is, yun, continuing use. Until sa, hindi na siya magagamit, so abandon na. Yung pangalawa is through a sale transaction. Yan yung another path na pwede niyang daanan. Yung una, continuing use, so gamit-gamitin mo lang hanggang sa hindi na magamit, so abandon na. Yun yung unang pwede mong gawin sa iyong non-current asset. Yung pangalawa mong pwedeng gawin, benta mo na lang, di ba? Benta mo na lang. I-Shopee mo, i-Lazada mo, di ba? Parang ganun. So, yan yung ano, generally, yan, dalawang path yung dadaanan ng non-current asset para sa ending ng kanyang buhay. Either continuing use hanggang sa ma-abandon siya, di ba? Kasi hindi na magamit, obsolete na, kumbaga. Or, ibenta mo na lang. Now, in this case, yung pinag-usapan dito sa PFRS 5 is yung non-current asset mo, yung disposal group per se, kinaklasify mo sa as held for sale or held for distribution to owner, kung saan yung pinili mong path para sa buhay niya is ito, sale, ibibenta mo. Recovered principally through a sale transaction. Yun ang meaning niya. O yun yung point ni PFRS 5. Sale transaction. O isa na, nawala na. Yun. O kasi, ang continuing use, yung carrying amount niya, ma-recover mo sa continuing use in sense of a depreciation. Parang ganun. On the other hand, itong sa sale, yung clearing amount, recovered principal nito, ay sale transaction. Ibibenta mo. Kaya nga sa pangalan, di ba? Non-current asset na kung saan, instead of using it or recovering the clearing amount through continuing use hanggang ma-abandon, you've chosen na ibenta mo na lang. Clearing amount, recovered principal through a sale transaction. Non-current asset, held for sale. Ganon. So, pinag-usapan natin yung core principle niyan. Di ba? So, bakit ngayon? Or bakit ngayon? I mean, paano natin masabi? Ano yung mga conditions? Ano yung mga qualifications na kailangan mong ma-meet para yung non-current asset na yan maklasify mo sa under PFRS 5? Provided naman yan ng standard. Ito yun. Di ba? Una, conditions. Ako, conditions for classification as held for sale. Di ba? Una, a non-current asset or disposal group, kapag combination yan, o grupo sila, makaklassify mo as held for sale if lahat, tandaan nyo, nakalagay dito, lahat, all of the following, dapat lahat yan, ma-qualify, ma-check, o dapat present yan. If all of the following conditions are met, ano yun? Una, the asset or disposal group is available for immediate sale in its present condition, subject only to terms that are usual and customary, meaning, alangan, ibibenta mo eh. Di ba? Hindi mo na kailangan ng mga ng mga malakihang preparation para mapunta sa condition na pwede siyang ibenta. Hindi. Dapat ready na siya. Ibenta. Nandyan na. Oo. Nandyan na sa'yo. Benta mo na lang. Yun na lang yung basically kailangan mong gawin. Subject only to terms that are usual and customary. Like yung mga ano, licenses, di ba? Taxes, ano, transfer of ownership, yung mga titulo, yung mga customary and usual yun. Hindi na kailangan ng massive or gradual or significant preparation in order to put the non-current asset into a condition na pwede na siyang mabenta. Dapat immediately available. Benta na lang, di ba? So yan yung una. Pangalawa, the sale is highly probable, significantly more likely than not. Paano pag-usapin like? Di ba? Hierarchy, virtually certain, probable, possible, remote, 'di ba? Ganun yung ano. Ito, highly probable siya nang din 'yan. Sa borderline siya na ano. Sa borderline siya ni probable pati ni virtually certain. So ibig sabihin, medyo sure na kayo, 'di ba? Almost sure na kayo na mabebenta 'yan. Kasi 'yun nga eh, held for sale. So the sale is highly probable. Kaya na sa pangalan mismo ng standard, held for sale. Ibig sabihin, ibebenta mo talaga and the sale, the transaction itself is highly probable. To happen. Now, paano natin malalaman? Oh, may criteria yan under sa the sale is highly probable para masabi mo na yes, the sale is highly probable. Una, management is committed to a plan to sale, di ba? Nag-usap sila ng mga broker, di ba? Mga sales agent para sila maghanap na, di ba? Mga broker, real estate broker para sila yung maghanap ng buyer. Committed to a plan to sell the asset or nag-ano sila ng marketing campaign. Not necessarily, yung classified ads, di ba? Plano yun. An active program to locate a buyer has been initiated, yun. Maghanap ka ng broker, yung broker yung maghanap ng buyer, di ba? The sale price is reasonable in relation to its current fair value, obviously, because that is a sale eh. The sale is expected to be completed within 1 year. Yan yung ano, yan yung nagpapa current asset sa kanya. The sale is expected to be completed within 1 year. Within 1 year. Yan yung reason bakit non-current asset held for sale even though nasa pangalan niya is non-current asset, it is classified as current asset sa ating balance sheet. Because the sale is expected to be completed within 1 year. Yung operation nyo, yung purpose mo dyan, short term lang, hindi long term. Kaya hindi siya kinoconsider as a non-current asset, a non-current sa yung balance sheet, but rather a current asset because the operation is intended only for short term. Yan yung reason. Kaya sale is expected to be completed within 1 year. And it's unlikely that a plan will of sale will be withdrawn. Ibig sabihin, sure na kayo. Na? Ibebenta niyan. Wala nang ano, back out, di ba? So yan yung reason. O yan yung mga ano, palatandaan na that the sale is highly probable. So tandaan nyo, current, kahit na sa pangalan niya is non-current asset, it is a current asset pagdating sa balance sheet. Kaya lang yan nandyan yung pangalan na non-current asset kasi yung scope niya is yung mga dating na-classify as under this, di ba? Kung saan ibibenta mo na. Yeah? Kaya nasabi, yung non-current asset mo ngayon ibebenta mo na. Yun lang yun. Yung non-current asset mo na to, ibebenta mo na. So, in so looking at it, it is a current asset. Bakit? Kasi the operation is expected to be completed within 1 year, which is short term. And as we know, short term is current. Ngayon, itong 1 year requirement na to, may exception tayo dyan, kapatid. Oo, may exception tayo dyan. An extension of the period required to complete a sale does not preclude an asset or disposal group from being classified as held for sale. Oo. Kasi may mga, no, may mga instances talaga na wala eh. Hindi kahit gusto mong ibenta within 1 year, hindi pwede. Oo, may mga ganyang instances. Sabi ni Standard, don't worry. May exception tayo dyan. Pwede ka mag-extend. Pwede mong extend yan. So ito yung sila. Unang reason, pwede. Oo. The delay is attributable to events or circumstances beyond the entity's control. For example, ngayon, COVID, yeah? Lockdown, na nahirapan kayong ibenta. Oh, di ba? May nahirapan kayong ibenta yung non-current asset to. So don't worry. COVID is beyond the entity's control dahil sa lockdown, di ba? So nahirapan kayo. So don't worry. Exception, you are allowed to extend. Oh, yeah? Beyond the entity's control eh. Second, there is sufficient evidence that the entity remains committed to its plan to sell the asset or disposal group. Yeah? Sure na sure pa rin. Huh? Committed kayo. Hindi tulad ng shota mo, hindi committed sa'yo. Itong entity dapat committed pa rin na ibenta yung asset. Decidido pa rin siya, kumbaga. Ito, napag-usapan natin ito. Events after reporting period, PS10 to sigurata ito, no? PS10. So, if the criteria for classification, ibig sabihin ito may criteria mo, tawag dito, if the criteria for classification as held for sale are met after the reporting period, an entity shall not classify the non-current asset as held for sale in those financial statements. Eh, di ba? But ito, di ba? Napag-usapan natin ito yung events after reporting period, PS10 ata ito. But ito, ending mo, December 31. Yung criteria mo for classification before December 31, before mag-end yung reporting period, na-check mo na, okay, classified mo as non-current asset held for sale. Pero pag yung criteria mo after, then, na-check mo yung criteria for classification after the reporting period, then, huwag mo i-classify under PFRS 5. Pero pag before, then check mo. Di ba? Napag-usapan natin yan. Si events after reporting period. Ngayon, dito tayo sa next slide natin. Non-current assets that are to be abandoned. O, di ba? Iniwan ka. Iniwan mong asset, gaya ng ginawa sa'yo. An entity shall not classify as held for sale a non-current asset or disposal group that is to be abandoned since, bakit? Kasi nga, the carrying amount will be recovered through continuing use rather than principally through sale. Kaya, di ba? Kasi, kita nyo dito, kung saan, non-current asset classified as held for sale kasi yung core principle niya, di ba? Yung purpose niya is yung carrying amount niya will be recovered principally through a sale transaction. Now, if abandon yung pinag-uusapan, then it is yung carrying amount not recovered to a sale transaction but rather to a continuing use. Di ba? Kasi abandon eh. Ibig sabihin, wala kang gagawin dyan. An entity shall not account for a non-current asset that has been temporarily taken out of use as if it had been abandoned. Ngayon, pumunta tayo sa accounting nito. So, napag-usapan natin, kailan tayo nag-classify as a non-current asset held for sale. Ngayon, pag na-classify na natin yan, o sabi natin yan, non-current asset held for sale yan, what to do next? Account mo na. O measurement mo na. Ito, dito tayo sa initial and subsequent measurement. So, ito. Meron ka na. Diyan yung asset mo. Non-current asset held for sale. Ngayon, yung initial measurement niya is lower of carrying amount and initial fair value less cost to sell. So, kung sinong lower sa kanila, yun yung kanyang initial measurement, basically. Ngayon, magkakaroon ng write-down. Oo, magkakaroon ng write-down kapag yung carrying amount mo is higher than the fair value less cost to sell. Yeah? A write-down to fair value less cost to sell and related reversal thereof is recognized sa profit or loss. So yan. Pag carrying amount yung lower, then wala kang write-down. Pero kapag yung fair value less cost to sell yung lower, then magkakaroon ka ng write-down to the point of the, di ba? Kasi bumaba yung value ng ano mo eh, ng asset mo eh, di ba? Yeah, bumaba ang value niya. Etong carrying amount, pagdating sa ano, fair value less cost to sell. Yeah, fair value less cost to sell. So, write down yan. Yung amount dito, wala ka magagawa. Kawawa ka naman. So, saan yun? Reversal of impairment. Pag-usapan ito sa IS 36, reversal of impairment is recognized as gain to the extent of cumulative impairment loss that has been recognized and depreciation amortization ceases during the period an asset is classified as held for sale. Obviously, wala nang depreciation or amortization yan. Bakit? Kasi hindi na yan long term eh. Short term na yan. Hindi na yan long term. Short term na yan. Kaya wala nang depreciation, wala nang amortization. Kasi current asset na yan. Kasi short term yung kanyang nature. Ngayon, paano pag nagbago yung isip na entity? Like, ay, huwag na natin ibenta. Anong gagawin nyo? Eto, provided naman ni standard, ano yung next step na pwede mong gawin kapag nagbago yung isip ni entity? Yeah? An uncurrent asset that ceases to be classified as held for sale shall be measured at the lower. So yan, nagbago isip ni entity. Hindi niya na ibibenta yung kanyang non-current asset. Yeah? So, in that case, yung non-current asset mo, shall be measured at the lower. So, lower sa dalawang to. Carrying amount before it was classified as held for sale, adjusted for any depreciation, amortization, or evaluation that would have been recognized if at the first place it was not classified as a non-current asset held for sale. So, di ba? Napag-usapan natin yung nature niya, di ba? As if hindi mo siya classify. As if, from the start pa lang, continuous yung kanyang pag-adjust mo for depreciation, amortization, or evaluation. Yeah? As if hindi ka nag-classify as non-current asset held for sale under PFRS 5. And the second one is recoverable amount at the date of subsequent decision not to sell. Diba? And as you know, recoverable amount is the higher between fair value less cost to sell and value in use. Diba? Fair value less cost to sell and value in use. And as we know, value in use is the present value of all the cash flows. Diba? Future cash flows ng asset mo. So, the higher, ano, so in that case, the lower between the carrying amount, as if walang nangyaring held for sale, walang nangyaring reclassification to PFRS 5, and recoverable amount. So, sinong lower sa kanila? Yun. Ngayon, let's go to discontinued operation. Kasi nga, sa pangalan, no? Oh, discontinued operation. So, ano nga ba itong discontinued operation? Excuse me po. So, discontinued operation is a component of an entity that either has been disposed of or is classified as held for sale. So, yan yung reason bakit kasama siya sa pangalan. Kasi, diniscontinue mo na yung operation. So, a discontinued operation is a component of an entity that either has been disposed of or is classified as held for sale. And, represents a major line of business or geographical area of operation. For example, may branch ka dyan or may ano ka dyan. Diba? May branch ka dyan or may factory ka dyan sa isang lugar. Is part of a single coordinated plan to dispose of a separate major line of business or geographical area. And is ito. Like for example, alam yung, di ba? Yung Honda factory doon sa Luzon na nagsarado. Yeah, gumagawa sila ng konti. Honda ba yun? Or ano? Honda ba yun or Toyota? Honda tayo, di ba? Nagsara yung factory ng Honda doon sa Luzon. So, that is a major line of business kasi factory yan eh. Naggagawa kayo ng kakasakyan. Nag-produce sila ng sasakyan doon eh. Di ba? So, it is a disposal of a separate major line of business. That is a factory that produces cars here in the Philippines. Kung saan, binibenta rin dito and outside. And lastly, subsidiary acquired exclusively with a view to resell. Ito, uso to sa mga ano. Diba? Acquire ka subsidiary, diba? Business combination. Pag-usapan to sa last lecture video. Acquire mo yan kung saan ang purpose mo dyan is benta ulit, diba? Benta mo. Acquire, benta. Acquire, benta. Oh. Exclusively with a view to resell. So yan yung mga discontinued operations pinupoint out dyan. So ito, pinag-usapan yung component of entity. So ano nga ba itong component of an entity? A component of an entity comprises operations and cash flows that can be clearly distinguished operationally and for financial reporting purposes from the rest of the entity. It can be a cash generating unit or group of cash generating units. So yan, component of entity. Nadidistinguish mo basically understandable naman, layman's term yung ginamit niya. It can be distinguished from other, di ba? Other operations of the entity, may distinction siya. Di ba? Kaya, cash generating unit siya or a group of cash generating unit. So, ito. So, ito parang summary lang ng classification nila. Ito, pag-usapan natin ito. Non-current asset held for sale. Disposal group. Sa non-current asset held for sale, single non-current, parang ikaw, single non-current asset lang yan. Iisa lang. Kaya nga, non-current asset. Hindi non-current assets. Non-current asset. Kaya isa lang. So, presentation niya sa financial position mo, balance sheet. Kapag disposal group held for sale naman, di ba? A group of assets, ito kaya nga, disposal group, group, kasi pinagsama na sila. A group of assets na yan. Equipment, inventories, payables, directly related to equipment and inventories, statement of financial position na yung presentation niya. And lastly, discontinued operation. A component of an entity, kung saan yung presentation niya sa balance sheet mo and sa statement of profit or loss and other comprehensive income. So, presentation of discontinued operations. So, paano sa pinapresent? The results of operations of the discontinued operations including impairment losses and actual gain or on disposal, ang pag-present mo sa kanya is a single amount net of tax after profit or loss from continuing operations. Ibig sabihin, sineseparate mo sila, sinesegregate mo. Una, ano yung muna? Oh, profit or loss mo for continuing operation. Sa baba niyan, yan, discontinued operations na. And don't worry, hindi naman mahirap tong si discontinued operation. Oh, madali lang yan siya. Hindi huwag yung problemahin yan. Single line amount lang yan siya. Yung computation niya rin, hindi din mahirap. Add minus lang yung. Oh, hello sir, naloko na kami niya ng add minus lang sa accounting. Totoo naman, discontinued operations. Add minus lang yan siya. Net of tax, of course. Net of tax. If a component of an entity qualified as discontinued operation during the year, all of its results of operations before and after classification shall be classified as discontinued operations. So itong mga direct costs, itong mga additional notes lang itong mga kapatid. Direct costs associated to decision to dispose a component. Costs or adjustments directly associated with the decision to dispose of. So yung mga nagastos nyo in relation to that. With the decision to dispose a component should be recognized and shown as part of the discontinued operations. So, yung mga directly associated, isama mo sa discontinued operations mo. My example, such item as severance pay or employee termination. Siyempre, pag nagko-close ka, di ba, i-discontinue mo yung operation mo ng isang ng component entity mo, may mga workers ka dyan. So, kailangan mo silang bayaran. And provided naman sa batas, yung mga severance pay and other employee termination costs, additional pension costs, minadali nyo yung yung retirement nila, employee relocation expenses, like transfer mo from this one component or from this one branch, transfer mo sa kabilang branch, di ba? Future rental or on long-term leases. Like for example, di ba? Mayroon kayong usapan ng lessor mo na ililease mo yun for 10 years, pero after 5 years, di ba? After 5 years, terminate mo na. Discontinue operations mo na. Eh, paano yun? Usapan nyo 10 years. Eh, siyempre yun. Future rentals on long-term leases, babayaran mo yun. Oo. Ito naman, comparative information. If in the current year, a component of an entity is classified as discontinued operation, so kung 2010, classify mo sa discontinued operation, an entity shall represent the disclosure for prior periods. Disclosures lang, ha? Disclosures for prior periods presented in the financial statement so that the disclosure relate to all operations that have been discontinued by the reporting period for the latest period presented. Kasi bakit? Bakit mo kailangan sabihin, i-disclose sa iyong prior periods, FS, yung about sa discontinued operation mo for this current year? Basically kasi, yung mga conditions o yung mga events that led to that discontinued operations, most probably, it was already existing prior period. Beforehand, di ba? So kaya sabi dito, since that is most probably ganun yung nangyari, di ba? The conditions that led to that discontinued operations was already present prior period pa lang. So at least present mo. Oo, represent mo sa disclosures mo for the prior period financial statements. Ito, events after the reporting period, same gist nito, yung criteria, kapag before the, ano, pag before the operating period, okay, adjusting yan siya. Pero pag after the operating period, yung criteria, non-adjusting yan siya. Disclose lang. So, ito, additional na lang. Cessation of classification as held for sale, effect on comparative statement of financial position. The cessation of classification as discontinued operations is accounted for retrospectively. So, babalikan mo. Hindi prospectively, but rather retrospectively, babalikan mo. The cessation of classification as held for sale, non-current assets and disposal groups that are not components of an entity is accounted for, ito naman, prospectively. So, let's go. May FS presentation pa. Last slide. Non-current assets held for sale and assets and liabilities of disposal groups are presented as current assets or current liabilities. Pero dapat separate sa from other assets and liabilities in the state of financial position. So, sabi natin, current assets sa iyong balance sheet. Take note, walang offset. Shall not offset the assets and liabilities of a disposal group. So, yan. PFRS 5. Let's go to classroom discussion, application of concepts. So, sa book to ni Zeus, problem 2 to classroom discussion. Number 1, topic, classification for as held for sale. According to PFRS 5, held for sale classification is permitted. Alin daw dyan? Non-current asset or disposal group? Non-current asset or disposal group is available for immediate sale in its present condition. Yeah. The sale is highly probable. Yeah. So, C, A, and B. Ano tong letter D? The sale actually occurred after the reporting period but before the financial statements were unauthorized for sale. Ah, ito yung mali dito. Yung after reporting period. Dapat before. Yung criteria dapat na-check na before pa the reporting period. So, ang correct answer, letter C. Measurement. According to PFRS 5, assets held for sale are measured at fair value, no? Fair value less cost to sell, yeah? Carrying amount, okay. Lower, okay. Ito. Kasi nandiyan yung lower. Fair value less cost to sell or carrying amount lower. So, discontinued operations. According to PFRS 5, a disposal group may qualify as discontinued operations if it is a component of an entity, yeah? It meets the held for sale classification criteria and so A and B, none of these. Okay, letter C kasi both of them. Number 4, presentation. The results of a discontinued operation are presented in the statement of profit or loss before the profit or loss from continuing operations but after the profit for the year. After the profit or loss from continuing operations but before for the profit of the year, yes, kasi ganyan sila, di ba? Continue operations, then discontinued operations. Pero basahin mo natin yung letter C. Separately from the profit or loss from continuing operations and it does not affect the profit. Ah, it affects, my friend. It affects. Ito yung nagpamali kanya. Does not affect. It affects, ladies and gentlemen. As an adjustment to the beginning balance, isa pa to. So, letter B. Lastly, number 5, which of the following is included in profit from discontinued operations? Extraordinary item. Which of the following is included in profit from continuing operations? So, extraordinary items, discontinued operations. Of course, separate na to. Discontinued, continuing ang hinahanap eh. Other comprehensive income. Oo, okay. Continue. Ano yun siya? Profit or loss yun siya. Other ko, OCI. Separate yan ng OCI. Extraordinary items. Ay, hindi rin yan. Income tax expense. So, profit yan eh. Pag kinocompute mo yung profit for continuing operations, pinabawas mo talaga income tax expense. Di ba? So, letter D. So, with that, yan yung discussion natin for PFRS 5. Next tayo. Okay. Dito tayo ngayon sa ating next topic, which is exploration for and evaluation of mineral resources under PFRS 6. Ngayon, yung PFRS 5 kanina sa Intermediate Accounting Part 1 yun kasi asset yun siya. Ito ring PFRS 6 Intermediate Accounting Part 1 din to siya kasi under to sa assets. So, ano nga bang learning objectives natin for this topic? Explain the accounting for exploration and evaluation expenditures. Madaling topic rin to siya, madaling standard lang to. So ano nga ba tong exploration and evaluation expenditure? Ano nga ba to siya? From the name pa lang, for mineral resources. So basically, para to siyang mining, yeah? Highly related to sa mga mining activities, oil producing, yan. Highly related tong topic na to doon. Ngayon, exploration for an evaluation of mineral resources. Ito yung search for mineral resources, including minerals, oil, natural gas, and other similar non-regenerative resources after the entity has obtained legal rights to explore in a specific area as well as the determination of the technical feasibility and commercial viability of extracting the mineral resources. So yan yung ano? Yan yung exploration for an evaluation. Yung ginagawa mong search, yeah, in relation to that mineral resources, in-account mo yan. Pinipresent mo yan sa iyong balance sheet. But take note, meron tayong, di ba? Kasi procedural man yan eh, di ba? Maghanap ka, develop mo, etc., etc. Meron lang tayong certain part of that procedure na sakop under PFR 6. Oo. So, di ba? After the entity has obtained legal rights to explore, dyan. Exploration and evaluation. Expenditures are expenditures incurred by the entity with the exploration for an evaluation of mineral resources before the technical feasibility and commercial viability of extracting mineral resources are demonstrated. Sir, anong mas klaro niyan? Tignan niyo, before. Ito yan. Diba? Diba? After obtaining legal rights and before the technical feasibility and commercial viability. Ito yun. Before obtaining legal rights, after, in between that, ito, yan yung PFR 6 mo. Okay? Oh, after the entity has obtained legal rights, dito yan. Oo. Oh. Ah, biniligtad. Oh, dapat A pala to siya. Sayang, nasira yung momentum. Yeah? After obtaining legal rights, but before technical feasibility and commercial viability, yan yung sakop ng PFR 6, di ba? Kasi procedure yan eh. Step-by-step process yan eh. Prospecting, di ba? Naghahanap ka saan pwede. Ano yung mga pwedeng ano, sites na kung saan may mineral resources na pwede mong kunin. Then may nahanap ka na, then start ka na. May napili ka ng site, then explore ka na. Di ba? Explore, hanap-hanap ka, then evaluate mo kung yung next, kung ano yung nakuha mo sa exploration mo was, ano, di ba? Kung, tawag dito, kung profitable ba? Oo. Feasible ba na pwede ka mag-operate dyan, mag-mine dyan, di ba? Exploration, evaluation. Yan. Kaya exploration, hanapin mo din. Based on your findings, evaluate mo. Mag-assessment ka. Ngayon, pag na-assess mo na, okay, goods. Goods to, maganda, profitable, sustainable, feasible tayo mag-operate dito. Then, start ka na development, ayusin mo na yung lupa, di ba? Mag-build ka na ng roads. Then, pag na-develop mo na yung, ano, yung site, then start ka na with the production. Oh, mag-mine ka na. Mine, kuha oil, di ba? Then, pag naubos mo na yung resources dyan, then closure and rehabilitation. Di ba? Ganun yung step. Ngayon, PFR 6, yung pinapoint out dito is, between this, ano lang, after obtaining the legal rights and before the technical feasibility and commercial viability, yun yung PFR 6. Yan yung i-report mo under PFR 6. Etong area na to. Ngayon, here's the thing about PFR 6. Kung yung ibang standard or most of the standard is very, ano, very strict, pagdating dito sa PFR 6, very lax siya. Very liberal, kumbaga. Bakit? Accounting for exploration and evaluation of expenditures. PFR 6 permits entities to develop their own accounting policy for exploration and evaluation assets which results in relevant and reliable information based entirely on management judgment and without the need to consider the hierarchy of standards under PASA. Now, as you can see here, very liberal, yeah? As compared sa maraming most of our standards na very strict, itong si PFRS 6, very liberal. So, bakit yan, sir? Tiyan mo, develop their own accounting policy that is more based entirely on management judgment, yeah? Because of the nature of the economic event itself. Or because of the nature of the economic event itself. The mining of the mineral resources. The gathering of the mineral resources. Kasi nga, very complex to sila. Oo. Very complex, very difficult to assess. So because of that nature, of the nature of this economic event, sabi ni PFR 6, sabi ng ano natin ng board ng na ganun ng standard, okay, because of the nature of the transaction, okay, you can develop your own accounting policy based on your management judgment para lang you will be able to present proper presentation ng transaction na yan because of the nature of the transaction, yeah, ma difficult, very complex mining yan eh. Oo, di ba? Kaya di ba magpo-prospect ka ng area saan dito pwedeng san possible na maraming ano, maraming resources. Tapos paano nag-fail? Paano if ano, di ba? Paano nag-fail? Paano nag-succeed? Di ba? Tapos very heavily regulated pa yan ng batas kasi ito lang yung pwede mong gawin, ito lang hindi mo pwedeng gawin. Dapat hindi ka destructive sa nature, di ba? Because of that, sabi ni ano, PFR 6, okay, liberal tayo dito. So, this means that the entity may recognize exploration and evaluation expenditures either as expense or asset depending on the entity's own accounting policy. Paano? Dito yan. So, dalawang method tayo meron, kapatid. Full cost method and successful efforts method. Now, sa full cost method, from the name itself, full cost. Lahat ng cost incurred in acquiring, exploring, and developing within a broadly defined cost center are capitalized and amortized. So, kinakapitalize mo lahat ng nagastos mo dyan. Lahat, kakapitalize mo. Then, amortize. So, with that, ibig sabihin, lahat yan, lahat ng ginastos mo, magiging asset, i-consider mo sa asset, ikakapitalize mo. Under this method, costs are capitalized kahit na yung specific project na yun sa cost center is a failure. So, pagdating kay full cost method, it does not matter if you will succeed. Diba? Kasi, mag-explore ka, i-evaluate mo kung meron ka dyan, feasible ba dyan, o may makukuha ka ba dyan, mineral resources. Diba? What if nag-fail ka? What if nag-succeed ka? Sabi ni full cost method, wala akong pake dyan. Lahat, i-capitalize mo. Whether you will succeed or whether the project is a failure. Pagdating kay successful efforts method, or from the name itself, successful efforts. Many costs are capitalized and amortized. So, cost of unsuccessful acquisition and exploration activities are charged to expense. Kasi nga, yung kinakapitalize mo lang yung success. O, yung successful lang. Yung mga failures, nga unsuccessful, kumbaga, charge to expense. So, cost whose outcome is unknown are either expense or capitalized. Now, in this case, as you can see, sino yung conservative yung estimates? Diba? Si successful effort method. So, sabi niya, no, standard, when the problem is silent, use successful effort method. Kasi pagdating kay full cost method, lahat capitalized natin. Accounting is conservatism, kapatid. Most lalo na pagdating sa asset, di ba? Hindi ayaw nating mag-overvalue yung asset natin kasi pag tingnan mo, full cost method, kahit na failure 'yan, gagawin mo ano? Lahat ng expenses mo, gagawin mo ano? Capitalism sa asset, hindi lolobo ang asset mo. Lalaki 'yan, di ba? So pagdating kay successful method, tamang ano, sakto lang. Kung successful, okay. Capitalize natin, di ba? Tamang ano lang. Kung when the problem is silent, successful effort method. Change accounting policies, etc. Ngayon, punta tayo sa measurement. And as we have said, develop their own accounting policy based on management judgment. So, paanong measurement dito? Sabi na IFRS 6 requires the entity to measure the asset initially at cost. So, yan yung initial measurement, cost. So, some expenditures might include, ito listed yan, acquisition of rights to explore, topographical, yung maginagawa nila sa part na to. Yung exploration evaluation. Ito yung ginagawa nila. Diba? Sampling activities para to determine if feasible ba yung project. Oh, makamain ba tayo dito? Kikita ba tayo? Profitable ba? Note expenditures related to the development of mineral resources, preparations for commercial production, such as building roads and tunnels, cannot be recognized as exploration evaluation of assets. Oh, hindi yan. Kasi, nandito na yung part yun sa development na yan. So, property, plant, and equipment used to develop or maintain exploration or evaluation assets also cannot be recognized as exploration and evaluation of assets. So, yan yung sa initial measurement. Now, let's go to subsequent measurement. So, sa subsequent measurement, entity classifies an exploration and evaluation asset either as a tangible asset under IS 16, gaya ng mga vehicles and drilling rigs, yung mga malalaking equipment nila, yung nag-drill, yung nagba-backhoe, di ba? Or, yung second is either intangible asset under IS 38, which is yung drilling rights, di ba? Yung mga binibigay na license sa yung government, the rights, yung mga leases. After initial recognition, an entity applies one of two measurement models to exploration and evaluation assets, the cost and evaluation model. So, yan. So, maikli laman to si, ano, si PFRS 6. So, sa impairment, siyempre may impairment tayo dito. Sa IFRS 6 or PFRS 6, requires exploration and evaluation asset to be assessed for impairment when facts and circumstances suggest na yung carrying amount ng exploration and evaluation asset mo may exceed its recoverable amount. So, yan lang. Di ba? Maikli lang si exploration and evaluation. Now, let's go to the application of concepts. So, exemptions from hierarchy of reporting standards under PS8. According to PFR 6, expenditures on exploration for and evaluation of mineral resources are recognized as asset expenses. Yes, kasi dito. A or B, depending on the entity's accounting policy, not accounting for. So, ito, letter C. Measurement. According to PFR 6, how are exploration and evaluation assets measured? Diba? Sabi natin, cost, then, next, ito. So, cost and cost of evaluation model. So, letter C. So, yan lang. Next topic tayo. So, dito tayo ngayon sa ating next topic, which is PFRS 8, operating segment. As you can see, nag-skip muna tayo sa PFRS 7. Combine natin sa PFRS 9. So, dito muna tayo sa PFRS 8, operating segments. And this is also another topic sa or another standard sa FAR na madali lang. So, operating segment, if I remember correctly, sa intermediate accounting part 3 yan siya. O, sa IA 3 yan siya, nasasama. And chill lang tong topic ito. So, anong learning objectives natin mga kapatid? Una, define ano ang isang operating segment. O ano ba nga? Ano nga ba ang operating segment? Pangalawa, describe yung management approach to identifying reportable segments. And pangatlo, state daw the quantitative threshold in identifying reportable segments. So, ano nga ba itong core principle ng PFRS 8? Ang sabi ni PFRS 8, ito daw yung kanyang core principle. An entity shall disclose information to enable users of its financial statements to evaluate the nature and financial effects of the business activities in which it engages and the economic environments in which it operates. So, yan yung core principle ni PFRS 8. Si entity, siyempre, doing business. So, ang sabi, para mas magkaroon ng available information ang users para sa kanilang decision making, magbibigay ng additional disclosure. Oo, kasi itong si operating segment sa disclosure part to siya. Magbibigay ng additional disclosure si entity para mas maliwanagan, kumbaga, si user kung ano yung nature. Ano yung mga pinagagawa ni entity sa kanyang mga operations. And yung i-disclose niya na is yung mga operating segments. Para magkaroon ng idea si users, ito palang ginagawa ni entity. Itong mga operating segments niya, maganda ang kanilang operations. Profitable, mga ganun, di ba? So, scope ni PFRS 8. So, si PFRS 8, it is applied sa mga separate individual and consolidated financial statements ng mga entity na publicly listed. Ibig sabihin, nasa stock exchange, parang ganun. Or in the process of enlisting publicly. So, ito sila, required silang mag-report ng PFRS 8. An unlisted entity that chooses to apply PFRS 8, so kahit ito, Kapag yung entity, hindi naman siya publicly listed or hindi siya in the process of enlisting publicly, pero trip niyang mag-report ng PFRS 8, then, kung ganun yung gagawin niya, then, that entity shall comply with all of the requirements of PFRS 8. Oo, either all or nothing, basically. Kung gusto mag-PFRS 8, then lahat kailangan mo i-report. Kapag hindi lahat, then otherwise it shall not be prescribed information as segment information. Oh, all or nothing basically. If a financial report contains both consolidated and separate FS ng of a parent that is within the scope of PFRS 8, so publicly listed parent corporation, ang sabi dito, kasi di ba dalawa yan eh, consolidated FS and separate FS. Yung separate FS, yung sa kanya lang. Yung consolidated, yung combine na ng mga entities, yung mga parent subsidiaries niya, kinombine na yung ano nila, basically pinagsama na as one, yung kanilang FS, yun yung consolidated, PFRS 10 natin yan. So, in that case, kapag pareho siyang may consolidated and separate FS, then, yung segment information required lang sa consolidated. Hindi required sa separate FS niya, but rather, required lang sa consolidated. Pero pag trip niya, mag-ano rin sa separate FS niya, okay lang. Kasi ang required lang naman is consolidated. Wala namang prohibition doon. Ngayon, ano nga ba ang operating segment? Kasi yan man yung ano eh. Yan yung pangalan ng, o yan yung title ng standard. Operating segment. So, ang operating segment, component siya ng entity. And as we know, napag-usapan natin yung component sa previous ano, previous topics, a component is a, of an entity comprises operations and cash flows that can be clearly distinguished, di ba? Operationally and for financial reporting purposes from the entity. Yan yung component, di ba? Ito ang entity. Then may component siya na ma-distinguish natin operationally for financial reporting, di ba? From the rest, component of the entity. Ma-distinguish natin siya, ah, ito siya. Oo, no, di ba? Separable, di ba? Identifiable. Oh, ito, operating segment, ah, ito. Component ito na entity. Entity, di ba? Pero, oh, asa hula to yun siya. Pero ito, mga component ni entity that is distinguishable. Separable, identifiable. So, in that case, an operating segment is a component of an entity that is engaged in business activities from which, sa business activities na yan, it earns revenue and incurs expenses. So, yun, may profit siya, basically. So, including revenues and expenses relating to transactions with other components of the same entity. Meaning, hindi lang external business activities, hindi lang external revenues and expenses, but rather also within the entity itself, internally generated, kumbaga. So, hindi lang externally generated, but also, it includes the internally generated ones. So, yun, ha. Pangalawa, whose operating results are regularly reviewed by the entity's chief operating decision maker. So yan, regularly reviewed. So chief operating decision maker, CEO or COO, di ba? Chief operating officer, di ba? To make decisions about resources to be allocated to the segment and assess its performance. So dapat yung operating results regularly reviewed. And lastly, for which discrete financial information is available. Discrete financial information, ibig sabihin, meron kang may po-provide na FS for that entity na alam mong galing lang talaga sa entity na yun. Identifiable, kaya nga dito, distinguishable for financial reporting purposes, makakapag-provide ka ng FS solely for that operating segment, solely for that component. Yeah? So yan, yan yung masasabi nating operating segment is a component of an entity. May business activities kung saan hindi lang externally generated yung revenues and expenses niya, also internally generated. Kung saan yung operations niya, reviewed by the chief operating decision maker, and by discrete FS siya. Or financial information, I mean. So, with that, napag-usapan natin yung operating segments. Ano nang gagawin mo next? Eh, di kailangan mo na siyang i-report. O, yan yun, di ba? Kalagay dito, disclose. The entity shall disclose the information. So, yung operating segments mo na yan, kailangan mong i-disclose yan. Kailangan mong i-report yan sa notes ng financial statements. Sa disclosure portion. So, an entity shall report separately information about each operating segment. So, each operating segment that management chooses in making decisions about operating matters or those which results from aggregating two or more segments and and those that qualify under quantitative threshold. So, pag yung operating segment, napasok niya yung, ano, na-qualify siya under dito, or na-qualify siya under dito, or na-qualify siya under dito, then i-report mo siya sa disclosure mo. I-disclose mo siya sa notes ng FS mo. Oh, management, oh. Ano entity, di ba? Shall report separately information about each operating segment kapag that operating segment ginamit ni management in making decisions about operating matters or to those results from aggregating two or more of those segments, ibig sabihin kinombine, and or na-qualify sila without even doing this kasi nasama sila o naabutan nila yung quantitative threshold. As you can see, di ba, sa book, meron namang, sa book ni Zeus, di ba, merong ano doon eh, merong example doon yung sa quantitative threshold. So, ito, PFRS 8 adopts management approach. Di ba, isa yun sa mga learning objectives natin. Management approach, kung saan, yung management approach na yan, yan yung ginagamit in order to identify ano yung mga segments na pwede mong i-report, pwede mong i-disclose sa notes ng iyong financial statements. Management approach yung ginagamit. So, under sa management approach, operating segments are identified on the basis of internal reports that are regularly reviewed by the entity's chief operating decision maker in order to allocate resources to the segment and assess its information. Yan, dito yan, no? So, yan yung management approach yung ginagamit natin. Kumalaga yan. Theory siya na ano eh. Theory of accounts yan. Ba? Ito yung una. So, yan na yan. Pangalawa, dito tayo sa aggregating two or more of those segments. Ito, aggregation criteria. Ngayon, two or more operating segments may be aggregated into a single operating segments excuse me, if the segment have similar if the segments have similar economic characteristics and that the segments are similar in each of the following respect. So, dapat. So, yan yung mga ano eh. Bago mo sila i-aggregate, bago mo sila pagsama, siyempre dapat pareho sila sa isa't isa, di ba? May similarity sila. Alam nga, i-aggregate mo yung magkakaiba, edi mahirapan kang i-report yun. Mahirapan kang i-report yung segment na yun kasi iba yung nature nila dalawa eh. So, kailangan kung mag-aggregate ka, yung kapareho niya rin. Yung kapareho niya rin. And with that, provided naman ni PFRS 8, ano yung mga criteria na kakailanganin mo in order to know na pwede mo silang i-aggregate. Una, di ba? Have similar economic characteristics. Pareho yung ginagawa nila. And are similar in the following. Nature of the products and services, pare-pareho. Nature of the production process, types or class of customers for their products and services. The methods used to distribute their products or provide their services. And nature of the regulatory environment, if applicable, like banking, insurance, or public. Pag mag-aggregate ka, siyempre, follow the criteria. Dapat pareho sila basically. Huwag yung total, huwag yung opposite ng isa't isa. Yung ka-different niya kasi mahirap yung i-report eh. Ngayon punta tayo sa quantitative threshold para mag-report ng reportable segments. So, an entity shall report separately information that an operating segment that meets any of the following quantitative thresholds. So, di ba? Parang step by step siya. Una, tingnan mo yung management approach. Pangalawa, mag-aggregate ka. Then, kapag hindi nasama yung iba, huwag munang tapusin yung step. Meron pa tayong using the quantitative threshold. Oo, para ano, may step-step. Hindi nakasama. Una, management approach. Yeah? Then, aggregate ka. Then, pag hindi pa nasama yung iba, okay. Punta ka sa quantitative threshold kasi may masasama pa yan. And usually, pagdating dito sa ano, pag mag-ano, dito sa PFRS 8, pag mga questions na yan, usually dito yan sa quantitative threshold. So, ito yung quantitative threshold natin. The entity shall report separately about an operating segments that meets any of the following quantitative threshold. Meaning, any. So, pag nag-meet nyo yung ano, revenue, eto na-meet nyo yung una, okay, goods na kahit hindi niya meet yung iba. Pag na-meet nyo itong pangalawa, hindi niya na-meet yung una o yung pangatlo, okay, goods pa rin. At least isa, ma-meet niya. Yan, ha? So, the segment, unang qualifying threshold or quantity threshold na i-check mo is that yung segment na yan, yung operating segment na yan, yung revenue niya is at least 10% ng total revenues externally and internally generated. Okay? So kapag yung entity merong may step naman yan, di ba? May example naman sa book ni Zeus. Kapag yung entity merong 100 million total revenues externally and internally generated, yung segment merong 12 million, di ba? On its own, nakapag-produce ng 12 million revenue yung operating segment na yan, then lumampas sa 10% threshold, okay, reportable. Di ba, ganun. Pangalawa, segment's asset. Yung operating segment na to may asset na at least 10% ng total assets externally and internally. So, anong meaning yan? Ang example ng internally, inter-segment receivable, so between the segments. Di ba? Pag yung total assets ng entity is 10 million, si itong si segment na to, meron siyang 1.5 million asset on its own, di ba, sa kanya. That is distinguishable or identifiable sa kanya. Then lampas yung sa 10% threshold. Pasok mo yan. Reportable siya. Pangatlo, the segment profit or loss is at least 10% of the greater in absolute amount ng combined. So ito, check nyo to. Klaro naman sa sa example sa book ni Zeus, di ba, itong pangatlong to, di ba? As you can see, the segment profit or loss is at least 10% of the greater in absolute amount of una. So the greater between these two, ha? The greater between these two and in absolute amount. Bakit mahalagang absolute amount? Kasi as we know, sa profit, automatic, di ba, positive na yan. Pero yung loss, di ba, alam natin, negative na yun. So, pag negative yan, lagyan mo pa rin ng yung absolute, yung ting, di ba, yung ting, para maging siya. Kasi absolute amount yung kailangan. Wala tayong pake kung negative or positive, absolute amount yung tinitingnan. So, the greater between the two, the combined reported profit of all the operating segments that did not report a loss and the combined reported loss of all the operating segments that reported a loss. As you can see sa sample books, di ba? Sa sample ni Zeus, di ba? ABC, di ba? Meron profit. Si DRE, DNE, loss. So, yung profit, i-add mo. Yung loss, i-add mo. Diba? Yung profit, i-add mo. Sana. Yung profit, i-add mo. Yung loss, i-add mo. Kung sino mas malaki sa kanilang dalawa, then yun yung magiging base ng 10%. Yun yung magiging base kung saan ita-times mo yung o yung mumultiply mo yung 10%. The greater between the total. The greater between the total profit and the total loss in absolute amount. So, sino yung greater sa kanila, yun yung magiging base mo para doon mo i-multiply si 10% threshold. So, yun. Pag na-meet yung 10% threshold, goods. Ngayon, ito, mayroon pang limiting, mayroon pang caveat, kumbaga. Meron ka ng reported segments. Yeah? Meron ka ng reported segments. Kaso, di ba, segment A, B, C, D. And take note, yung entity, the entity itself, the entity has 100 million external revenue. Has 100 million external revenue. Kaso, nung ginawa mo na itong mga step, yung mga admin principles, yung quantitative threshold, nalaman mo na itong mga reported mga operating segments mo na reportable, 70 million lang yung kanilang external revenue. Hindi umabot sa 75%, which is 75 million, di ba? So in that case, magdagdag ka pa basically. Magdagdag ka pa ng segment until ma-reach mo yung 75%, at least 75%. In this case, 75 million. O, kasi yung total external revenue ng reportable segment should be at least 75% ng entity's external revenue. So kung 100 million yung external revenue ng entity, dapat at least 75% nun ang total external revenue ng mga segment na na-deem mo as reportable. So, in this case, 75 million lang. 70 million lang. So, magdagdag ka pa until ma-reach yung 75% threshold. So, yan na. Mga tips. Additional. Oh. Ito naman, disclosure of major customer. So, pag meron ka major customer that is single, a major customer is a single external customer providing revenues of 10% or more of an entity's revenue. So, you need to disclose the fact na meron kang customer na kung saan 10%, at least 10% ang revenue mo galing sa customer na yan, ng external revenue mo. Ngayon, of course, sinabi naman, hindi mo kailangang identify kung sinong customer dyan. You just need to state the fact na may customer kang 10% at least 10% yung revenue yung nakukuha mo sa kanya. Ganon. Oo. Nakalagay naman sa book. So, other disclosures. Entity-wide disclosures apply to all entities subject to PFRS 8, including those entities that have a single reportable segment. Applicable. Revenues from external customers attributed to the entity's country of domicile and attributed to all foreign countries in total from which the entity derives revenues. Sama yan. Non-current assets other than financial instruments, deferred tax assets, post-employment benefit, assets and rights arising under insurance contract located in the entity's country of domicile and located in all foreign countries in total in which the entity holds assets. So basically, additional disclosures lang ito nilalagay mo. So let's go to classification of assets. Classification of assets, application of assets. Whew. So yung una, management approach. Si Catalyst Co. is engaged in a business process outsourcing. So BPO siya. Catalyst categorizes its main services into four. Information technology, after sale support, accounting, and offsite data management. So yung apat yung kanyang ano. Services na ino-offer niya. Excuse me po. So Catalyst operates in five major geographical areas. Southeast Asia, North America, South America, Australia, and Europe. So internal reports are based on these five geographical areas. So what is the appropriate basis of segment reporting for Catalyst? So paano? Kasi kita nyo dito, meron siyang apat na services and nag-ooperate siya sa five major geographical areas. So paano daw yung ano yung magiging basis mo sa iyong segment reporting? Yeah? So in this case, yung magiging basis mo yung on the basis of the geographical areas of operation. Yan yung magiging basis mo sa segment reporting mo. So, Southeast Asia, North America, South America, Australia, and Europe segments. Kasi, di ba? Kasi these services naman are offered in each of this area. So, yan. Yeah? So, yan yung magiging basis mo sa segments. Number two, quantitative threshold. Segment A qualifies under the 10%. Test of total revenues, but not on profit or loss, and total net total asset test. Segment A is may be reported as segment. Bakit? Kasi ang sabi lang naman eh, di ba? Ang sabi dito, any. So kahit hindi ka maka ano sa threshold ng iba, pero na sakto ming threshold dito sa isa, okay, reportable ka. Di ba? Walang problema dun. Ngayon ito naman, ito less complicated, mas simpleng question to as compared doon sa ano, sa example na provided sa book ni Zeus doon sa chapter ng operating segments. So yun, mas maganda yun kaysa dito sa number 3. Kasi of course CFAS is all about ano eh, theories of accounts to. Information of an entity operating segment is shown as below. So ito, kasi as you can see, diba, sa sample ng sa book ni Zeus, merong loss. Ito, profit lang na nakalagay. So ang tanong sa atin, the reportable segments are, so yun lang. So kuha kayo calcu, check nyo. Diba? Una, total revenue. Oh, total revenue is 3.4 million. So, 1 million divided by 3.4. Oh, 29%, 29% tong si A. Okay, goods. 500 divided by 3.4. Oh, 14%. Okay, goods. Oh, 300 divided by 3.4. Hindi siya nakaabot. At 500 divided by 3.4. Huh? Okay, 14%. 200. No? Sure natin ito makasama. Oh, hindi rin to. See. Oh, 900. Oh, di ba? Check lang. 26%. Okay. So, sa total revenue, si A, B, D, and F, reportable. So, reportable na sila. Sa profit naman, as you can see, wala tayong loss. So, absolute value lang yung profit ang gagamitin natin. Automatic ay profit kasi wala tayong loss. So, 10% ulit. 10%. So, 200 divided by 860, 23, di ba? 120 divided by 860, 13%. Okay. 30,000, alam natin dito kasama. 860. Oh, 3%, alam natin ito kasama. Pero of course, gawin, compute pa rin natin para sure kahit nga 1 plus 1, kinocompute natin eh. Kasi dapat sure tayo sa ating computation, sa ating answers. Ayan ito, of course, 400 by 860, oh, 46%. O, reportable lang si A, B, and F. Ngayon sa identifiable asset tayo, 10% ulit, so 9.3 million. 4 divided by 9.3, oh, 43%. 1 divided by 9.3, oh, 10.7%. Okay, 800 divided by 9.3. Oh, hindi kasama si C. 1.7 divided by 9.3. Oh, 18%. 800. Oh, same lang. Kasi 800 to dito. 1. Oh, ito same din. So, sa total revenue, ang reportable is si A, B, D, and F. Sa profit, ang reportable lang si A, B, and F. Sa identifiable asset, ang reportable si A, B, D, and F. So, with that, ang reportable natin dito is si A, B, D, and F lang. Si C and C, E, wala. Hindi sila check. Eh, hindi sila kaabot. So, quantitative threshold ang letter B. So, di ba? Ang simple ni, simple lang si operating segments. So, IFR, intermediate accounting part dito siya. So, with that, next topic tayo. So, hello. Dito tayo ngayon sa next topic natin, which is PFRS 9 Financial Instruments. Now, ito, na-mention naman natin ito nung ano, itong PFRS 9 Financial Instruments, kapatid nito si ano, other related standards nito is PAS 32, yung na-discuss natin sa previous lecture video. Oh, yung, sir, bakit ganun? Akala ko financial instruments yan dito sa parte. Bakit sa previous lecture video na discuss? Kasi nga, pinalo natin yung yung table of contents sa book ni Zeus. So, yun, PS32 yun. Ito, PFRS 9, bago. So, with that, na-follow natin yung ano sa table contents. But, ito yung main bulk ng ano ng discussion for financial instruments. Yung PS32, the financial instrument financial instrument presentation, presentation ba yun? Disclosure. Check ko daw. PS32, financial instrument presentation, supporting yung supporting standard siya ni, ano, ni financial instruments PFRS 9. And si PFRS 7 rin, plus si PFRS 7, supporting standard niya rin, or sa yung support, it is also a supporting standard of PFRS 9. So, yung main bulk ng discussion ng financial instruments na kay PFRS 9. Yung dalawa, si PS32 and si PFRS 7, supporting lang sila ni PFRS 9. So, with that, let's go to ano. Don't worry. Sa lecture video na to, didiscuss rin natin si PFRS 7 and isasama ko rin yung portion ng discussion sa PS32 dito sa video na to from the previous lecture video para at least make flow ng or related yung discussion na mangyayari. So, PFRS 9, financial instruments, ito yung learning objective siya kapatid. State the classification of financial assets and their initial and subsequent measurement and state the classification of financial liabilities and their initial and subsequent measurement. Now, ganito yan. Itong si PFRS 9, ito yung sa isa to sa mga pinaka nakakahilong subjects or topics for the board exam under FAR. Bakit? Kasi, well, hindi naman siya mahirap, basically. Kasi may madaling maintindihan yung kanyang ano, yung kanyang discussion. However, the problem with PFRS 9 is masyado siyang marami. Marami kang kailangan i-consider. Masyado siyang malaki. Hindi siya complex, pero marami kang kailangan basahin, marami kang kailangan intindihin, marami kang kailangan kabisaduhin para mag-gets mo yung standard na to. Yun yung issue kay, hindi man sir, issue, yun yung nagpapahirap kay PFRS 9. Pero pag titingnan mo, madali siyang intindihin. Kaso lang, marami kang kailangang intindihin. Yun yung problema sa kanya. And ito, baka yung iba sa inyo, mahilo or mapakamot ng ulo sa topic na to. Kasi, ang i-discuss lang natin, kasi kala nyo, isipin nyo, hala, full discussion naman. Hindi. Ang i-discuss lang dito is yung ano, is yung G's niya. Basically, yung inaano natin dito sa CFAS eh, yung G's ng topic. So, yun, yung summary lang ng topic dito. So, ang PFRS 9, yung portion niya, yung financial asset portion niya, of course, asset sa IAS 1 yan, Intermediate Accounting Part 1. Yung ano, yung financial liability portion niya, of course, sa IAS 2 sa liabilities portion. Doon yan sa madidiscuss. So, don't worry, hindi nakakahilo si PFRS 9. Masyado lang talaga maraming kailangang aralin. Pero madali lang tong topic na to. So, financial instruments can either be ano, financial asset or financial liability. So, ang financial asset is any asset that is considered to be cash, equity instrument, of course, dapat nabasa na yung book ni Zeus before kayo nagpunta sa video na to. Cash siya, equity instrument of another entity, like ano, stocks, di ba? And any contractual rights to receive cash or another financial asset or to exchange financial assets or financial liabilities with another entity under conditions that are potentially favorable to the entity. Like, for example, di ba, receivables. Uy, nag-pause ang video. Wait, deactivate natin. Nag-pause ang video natin. Nag-error siya. Pause ko. So, yun, bumalik na. So, saan tayo dito? So, para siyang ano, di ba? Para siyang ano, like for example, dito, receivables. Meron kang contractual right to receive cash or another financial asset. Di ba? Napag-usapan natin yan sa discussion sa ano, sa receivables and payables. In exchange financial assets or financial liabilities with another entity, kung saan yung conditions favorable sa kanyo. Sa'yo, di ba? Rights, favorable. Economic inflow to the entity, receivables. So yan, yun yung mga financial asset. On the other hand, ito naman yung mga financial liabilities. Is any liability that is may contractual obligation ka to deliver cash or another financial asset to an entity or a contractual obligation to exchange financial assets or financial liabilities with another entity under the conditions that are potentially unfavorable to the entity. Di ba? Obligation, liability. Ang outflow ng economic resources, di ba? Unfavorable yun sa'yo. So yan ha. Financial asset, ito sila. Financial liability, itong mga to. Yeah, mga loans, loan payable, trade payable. Dito naman sa financial assets, di ba? Ano? Trade receivables, loan receivables, or yung government bonds na kung binili mong government bonds, di ba? So with that, initial recognition and classification. Dito muna tayo sa financial asset. So, financial assets are recognized only when the entity becomes a party to the contractual provisions of the instrument. So, pag naging party na si entity, then financial assets are recognized and these are the financial assets, don't forget. Ngayon, paatin to kina-classify. Ito na yun. Kasi within the financial asset, meron tayong different classifications. Oh, later on. And before natin sabihin ko ano yung mga classifications na yun, yung magiging basis mo, oo, yung kailangan mo i-consider para ma-classify to as this, that, or this, or that, those, ano, is kailangan mong i-assess yung business model for managing the financial assets. And second, ano yung contractual cash flows characteristics of the financial asset. Ito yung dalawang kailangan mo i-consider para malaman mo kung ano yung classification ng financial asset na yun. Yung business model and yung contractual cash flow. Paano yan? Ito. Basis of classification and ito yung sa second column natin are the classification. So yung business model, ito, as you can see, ang dito, shortcut lang ginawa dito. Kasi of course, this is summary lang. G's lang yun. Pero pag titingnan yung standard, may medyo wordy siya. Pero basically, ito yung idea niya. So, basis of classification, yung business model is hold to collect. Meaning, hold to collect lang. Wala kang gagawin. Stagnant lang yun dyan sa'yo. Kasi yung purpose mo is to collect. Diba? Financial asset yan. Diba? Financial asset, meron kang right to receive. Yeah? Right to receive. So yun, hihintay mo lang. Yeah? Example, loan receivable, may nangutang sa'yo. So, dyan sa nangutang sa'yo, siyempre babayaran ka niyan. So, magko-collect ka lang. So, yun yung business model. Kung saan ang purpose mo lang is, i-collect lang yung utang. I-collect mo lang yung nangutang sa'yo. Yeah? Collect mo lang. Receivable. Receive. Yun yung business model. Then yung cash flow characteristics. Yeah? The second basis of classification, kung saan SPPPI na. Anong SPPI? Solely for payments of ano? solely payments for ano, for principal and interest. Meaning, yung marireceive mong cash flow, it's only from, or it's, it only comes from the principal and the interest from that principal. Yung di ba sa utang, yung principal utang plus yung interest niya. Yun lang yung cash flow characteristics. Diyan lang manggagaling yung marireceive mong cash flow. Solely payments of principal and interest. Yun lang yung marireceive mong cash flow. In that case, di ba, hold to collect. Yung purpose mo lang is collect yung utang. Kung sa yung cash flow characteristics, yung solely payments of principal and interest, dyan manggagaling yung utang sa pagbabayad lang ng principal and interest sa'yo. So in that case, example yan, debt instrument. Ano example? Receivable, di ba? Loan receivable ng utang. Nagpa-utang ka. So, since nagpa-utang ka, ang purpose mo lang is to collect the ano, receivable from that utang. Okay. Then, since utang yan, di ba? Principal, interest, yun yung ma-receive mo. Solely payment for principal, interest, debt instrument. In that case, the classification is amortized cost. Amortized cost. On the other hand, dito tayo sa pangalawang ano, classification. Tawag ito. Business model, hold to collect and sell. Yun na. May dagdag. Hindi lang basta hold to collect. Meron ka na rin, ano, meron ka na rin, ano, meron ka na rin reason, or ano, may reason, may additional ka na rin gagawin, yeah? May additional ka na rin gagawin sa financial asset na yan. Hindi lang para mag-collect ng receivable, but also with the purpose of selling it. But take note, just because sinabing ibibenta, oo, sa problem sabi ibibenta, it does not necessarily mean na automatic hot FM, ito na yun. Kasi titingnan mo yung business model. Kung ginagawa niya talagang business yung pagbebenta ng financial asset na yan, okay, goods. Pero kapag yung pagbebenta na yan is parang subsidiary lang ba? Parang secondary purpose lang. Hindi primary. Yeah? Parang secondary purpose lang. For example, nagka-problema, liquidity problem, so tsaka niya lang ibebenta. Oo. Yun, hindi yun makakonsider as under this. Kailangan yung sell na yan, it is a primary consideration. So, it is a primary objective, primary purpose na kung saan ginagawa niya talaga. It is part of the business model itself. Hindi lang basta secondary purpose, parang contingency, hindi ganun. Kasi pag contingency lang yan, like nagkaroon ng liquidity problems, kailan niya magbenta para magkaroon siya ng cash, then it is not under this classification. Okay? Dapat yung sell, primary consideration, primary objective rin yan. So in that case, kapag hold to collect and sell, dapat primary objective. So ito, cash flow characteristics, solely payments of principal and interest, pabochi yan siya. Ha? Pabochi. Fair value through other comprehensive income. Fair value through other comprehensive income, mandatory. Mandatory. Ibig sabihin, required kang gawin yan. Kaya nakalagay dyan mandatory dito, election. Ito, election, may choice ka. Ito, mandatory, wala kang choice, kailangan mong gawin. Required gawin. So in that case, di ba? Pabochi. Pabochi ang tawag naman dyan. Ang tawag dyan, yung parang lingo niya dyan. So, fair value through other comprehensive income. On the other hand, dito tayo sa pangatlong classification. Business model, not defined. Di kayo sure. Cash flow characteristics, not defined. Held for trading securities, equity instruments. Ito na yung mga ano, yung stocks, di ba? Stocks, mga shares. Ito na. I-classify mo sa fair value through profit or loss. FVPL. FVPL. Fair value through profit or loss. Ngayon, ito yung mga exceptions. Investment in equity securities, favochi election, eliminates or significantly reduces accounting mismatch, FVPL designated. Sir, medyo nahihirapan pa rin kami. May guide ka ba? Paano yan? Anong mas madaling gawin para sa classification? Ito oh. Yan lang ang tingnan nyo. Yan lang tingnan nyo. Classification of financial asset. Yan lang tingnan nyo. May financial asset ka. Debt instrument ba siya? No. Okay. Punta ka sa derivatives. Now, take note, itong derivatives, madidiscuss natin to sa ano? Sa, yung topic na to is under accounting for business combination, BAPE 7, so third year nyo to. Oh, kasi nga, advanced accounting tong topic na to, kasi nga, napaka-advanced nito, promise. Derivatives yan, derive, hedging yan, kapatid. Pero, yung topic na to, under to sa PFRS 9. Oh, PFRS 9, PS 32, and PFRS 7. Yan sila, andyan sila. So, going back, financial asset. Meron nga financial asset, debt instrument ba siya? Tingnan mo, no. Okay, derivative ba siya? Yes, okay. Diretso ka, financial asset at fair value through profit or loss, FVPL ka na. Ngayon, nakaano mo, hindi siya ano, hindi siya debt instrument, hindi siya derivative, so equity instrument 'yan. Held for trading ba? Held for trading, Yan yan. Oh, yes, okay. FVPL. Ah, hindi pala held for trading. Okay, no. Favoci option elected. Yan, no? Oh, investment in equity securities. Favoci option elected. Sinabi ba sa problem na nag-favoci option elected sila? No. Okay, diretso ka sa FVPL. Elected favoci option. Okay, financial assets are at fair value through other comprehensive income. Favoci. Nasa ano itong meaning ng no recycling and recycling? Itong no recycling and with recycling, problemahin nyo lang ito pagdating sa ano, pagdating sa in-depth discussion nyo for PFRS 9. Pero itong no recycling and with recycling, para to sum it up lang, it basically pertains to the ano, to the ano, nakalimutan ko yung term na yun. Yung revaluation nata yan? Basta yung, meron kang ano eh, meron, nakalimutan ko yung pangalan ng account na yun. Sa revaluation surplus ba yun? Basta something to do with equity. Doon yun kung pag nagkaroon ng reclassification, kung magkakaroon ng reclassification, itong recycling, within the equity lang. Pag no recycling, yung reclassification na mangyayari, not within the equity. Basta ganun yung ano, yung idea na naalala ko. Nakalimutan ko yung tamang name ng account eh. Pero ganun. Pero wala problema yun, of course. Geez lang yung summary lang pinag-uusapan natin dito, hindi yung in-depth discussion kasi CFAS lang to. Sa intermediate accounting niyan. Pero yun ha, yun yung meaning na recycling and with recycling yan dito. Ngayon dito. So, what if debt instrument siya? Yes, hold to collect contractual cash flows. Yun yung business model, hold to collect. Oh yes, oh, or no. Kung hindi ganyan, di ba? Kung no, hold to collect, kailangan hold to collect to sila. Kung no, edi FVPL na yan. Cash flows that are solely payments of principal and interest. No, okay, FVPL. Kasi tingnan nyo, para sa amortized cost and favoci, required hold to collect sell, SPPI. Ngayon, conditional fair value option elected. Oh, conditional fair value option elected. Yes, okay, FVPL. Yeah, ito, designated yan. Ngayon, kung hindi, then financial asset at amortized cost or financial asset at favoci. Fair value through other comprehensive income. So, ganyan ang kadali. Ngayon, paano malaman, sir, kung amortized cost yan or fair value through other comprehensive income? Tingnan mo yung sell part. Ayan. Di ba? Madali lang yan siya. Di ba? Madali lang intindihin. Ang problema lang, marami kang kailangang intindihin. Yun. So, huwag natin pahirapan yung mga bagay-bagay. So, ito, additional note, equity versus debt instrument. Tandaan nyo, only debt instrument can be classified under the amortized cost or favoci mandatory and measurement categories. Oh, kasi tingnan nyo dito, only debt instruments can be classified under amortized cost or favoci mandatory measurement categories. Kasi tingnan nyo sa equity instrument, di ba? Wala siyang amortized cost. Kasi sa debt instrument lang ang pwede. Equity instruments are measured at FVPL unless the entity makes an irrevocable election on initial recognition to measure them at favoci. Ito, favoci option elected. Ayan. A debt instrument that is not measured at amortized cost or at favoci is measured at FVPL. So, no. Ayan. Ayan, madali lang. Ito lang tingnan nyo, mag-gets nyo na, di ba agad? Ito yung mga business model, parang mga ano natin eh. Parang ito mga next na to. Parang additional ano lang. Nato sa additional, but rather parang examples. So ito, like sa ito, an entity. Una tayo dito. Ito ba yung una? Okay. Ito yung scenario. An entity acquires debt securities with which the entity will hold until maturity to collect cash flows in the form of principal interest. So you can see here, hold to collect to. SPPI. Yeah? Without reading the analysis, alam niyo na, hold to collect with SPPI in the form of principal interest. Ngayon, na-check mo na to. Yeah? Hold to collect na. Titingnan mo na ngayon kung may sell yan. Yeah? Titingnan mo kung qualified ba yung sell niya. However, in accordance with the entity's credit risk management, the entity will sell any investment in which the credit risk becomes high in order to minimize the losses. So, to, as you can see here, gaya na sabi natin kanina, yung sell part, yung sell, hold to collect and sell, dapat primary objective yun. Hindi lang secondary purpose, hindi lang pang contingency, hindi lang pang backup plan. As you can see here, yung sell portion, yung sell, contingency lang siya, pang backup plan. Yeah? So, ang analysis, the entity's business model is hold to collect, hold financial assets in order to collect the contractual cash flows. Okay. So, titingnan mo na siya, either Fabocchi or amortized cost. So, with that, the objective, this objective is not defeated by the mere fact that the entity sells this investment to address creditors. So, ito, since yung selling portion niya, hindi naman significant eh, pang backup plan lang eh. Pang backup plan lang. Contingency lang eh. So, classification, amortized cost. Huh? The debt security shall be classified as subsequent measured at amortized cost. Ngayon, let's go to the second scenario. An entity acquires debt securities which the entity will hold until maturity to collect cash flows in the form of principal interest. Okay, hold to collect, SPPI. Ngayon, titingnan natin yung sell portion. However, the entity will sell this investment when a stress case or worst case scenario occurs. So, kita natin, hindi siya primary objective, hindi siya primary purpose, pang backup plan lang, contingency lang. So, as you know, without reading this, hindi siya pwede makonsider as Fabocchi. So, with that analysis, the entity's business model is to hold financial assets in order to collect the contractual cash flows. This objective is not defeated by the mere fact that the entity sells investment to address a stress case scenario. This objective is also not defeated even when the entity has previously experienced a stress case scenario or have made recurring sales with insignificant value. Kasi nga, hindi na yung primary objective eh. Hindi yung significant na ginagawa ng entity. Pang backup lang, contingency. In that case, hold to collect lang siya. Walang sell. Kahit na may sell portion dyan, pero sabi natin, dapat yung sell primary. Hindi lang secondary, hindi lang pang backup, hindi lang pang contingency. Para makonsider siya as Fabocchi. In this case, since yung sell is only a contingency, so hindi siya primary, hindi siya significant, hold to collect SPPI, amortized cost lang yun siya. Ngayon, let's go to this another one. An entity holds financial assets to meet its everyday liquidity needs and to settle maturing accounts payable and other accrued liabilities. So, the entity actively manages its liquidity and therefore actively manages the return on the portfolio. Ngayon, accordingly daw, the entity holds financial assets to collect cash flows and sell financial. So, nakita kayong sell. Huwag basta-basta analyze yung kung ano yung pinapertain ng sell na yan. To collect cash flows and sell financial assets to reinvest in higher yielding financial assets. Also, the entity makes frequent buying and selling of financial assets to better match the duration of its liability. So, as you can see here, significant portion, primary objective ng entity yung selling ng financial asset. Not only to collect cash flows, but also to sell. Oh, kita nyo, big deal sa kanya, primary sa kanya. Significant yung transaction ng selling sa kanya. Hindi lang secondary, hindi lang pang contingency, hindi lang pang backup. So without reading this, alam nyo nang Fabocchi siya. Alam nyo nang Fabocchi siya. Yeah? So the entity's objectives are to maximize the return on the portfolio, to meet everyday liquidity needs, and to fund its maturing payables. The entity achieves this objective by both collecting contractual cash flows and selling the financial asset. So, with that, Fabocchi siya. Okay? Ngayon, ito naman. An entity holds assets with the purpose of selling them to realize fair value gains. So, held for sale. So, held for sale siya. Yeah? Held for sale siya, di ba? So, analysis. The entity's objective is not to collect contractual cash flows. Hindi yun. Hindi SPPI. Hindi ano. But primarily to sell financial assets to realize fair value gains. Classification, the financial asset is considered to be FVPL. Fair value through profit or loss. Yeah, mas naintindihan natin. Tingnan nyo talaga yung business model. Basis of classification, business model, paano minamanage yung financial asset and ano yung contractual cash flows. Dito, SVPI. Ano? Dito, for gains. Yeah? So, ito another summary. Yeah? FVPL. Kung saan, debt and equity siya. Basta titingnan nyo lang dito. Yeah? Titingnan lang dito. Si debt, ano sa kanya? FVPL, amortized, Fabocchi. derivative FVPL lang, equity FVPL lang, and FABOCI. So, statement of final current asset, fair value, change fair value, FABOCI, equity securities lang ang pwede, FABOCI election, FABOCI election, oh, FABOCI election, FABOCI mandatory, tandaan nyo yan. Current or non-current, change fair value without recycling, yun. Ito naman, pag mandatory, debt security siya, pag ano, election, ibig sabihin, ikaw mismo nag-elect, hindi pinapa-require sa'yo, pero ginusto mo, okay, equity yan. Pag mandatory, alam mo yung, alam mong nasa debt security yan. Current or non-current, yeah? Kasi, ano yung mga payables, di ba? Meron tayong trade payables, meron tayong loan payables, yung mga long-term, di ba? Ito sa equity securities, yung mga bonds, di ba? O, yan, tarat. Amortized cost, debt securities lang ang meron dyan. Oh, sa FABOCI, pwede siyang equity, pwede siyang debt. Pero, looking to much more specific, FABOCI election, yan lang yung sa equity securities. FABOCI mandatory, yan lang yung sa debt securities. Mas intindihan natin. Yeah? Madaling intindihin. Masyado lang, maraming kailangang intindihin. So, basta ang purpose lang natin dito is ano eh, to discuss the, ano, the G's, the summary. So, don't worry too much about it. Tsaka na sa intermediate accounting nyo. So, reclassification. After initial recognition, financial assets are reclassified only when the entity changes its business model for managing the ano, so reclassification. So yung reclassification date daw is the first date of the first reporting period following the change in the business model that results in an entity's reclassifying the financial asset. So additional notes lang yun sa reclassification, ang importante na gets nyo itong mga G's na to. So to notes on reclassification, basahin na lang, only debts, post nyo, basahin, okay, goods. Only debts, etc., etc., designated. Oh, financial assets cannot be reclassified into or out of the designated at FVPL and FVPL, ano, FABOCI election. Bakit? Because this is, ano na, irrevocable. Kumbaga, yun yung term na ginamit. Irrevocable. Once you reclassified it, huwag na. Only debt instruments can be reclassified. Equity instruments cannot be reclassified. So, to initial measurement is fair value at reclassification date except for reclassification from FABOCI to amortized cost where the fair value on reclassification date is adjusted for the cumulative balance of gains and losses previously recognized. So, yeah. Ito naman, nagkakaroon tayo ng impairment, IS 36 natin yan. The impairment requirements of PFRS 9 apply equally to both debt type financial assets that are measured either at amortized cost or at FABOCI. So, yan na-apply sa kanila. So, impairment gains or losses on debt instruments measured at FABOCI are recognized as profit or loss. However, the loss allowance shall be recognized in the OCI and shall not reduce the, ano, the carrying amounts of the financial assets in the statement of financial position. So, additional notes lang yan. Diba? Basta ito. Basta ang importante dito ngayon, mag-gets nyo to. Itong portion na to. Business model, contract of cash flows, paano ma-identify kung FABOCI yan, kung FVPL, kung amortized cost, di ba? Ito, basically, ito lang, di ba? Now, let's go to ano? Dividends received from equity securities measured at FVPL or FABOCI except share dividends are recognized as dividend revenue. So, basically, yan yung sana natin sa financial assets. Now, let's go to financial liabilities. Financial liabilities. Uy, naharangan siya. Financial liabilities. So, financial liabilities, amortized cost, or at fair value through profit or loss. And wag nyo na disregard nyo itong guidance sa specific financial liabilities. In-depth discussion na kasi ito sa, malilito lang kayo. So, disregard nyo yun sa baba, tatanggalin ko yun sa PowerPoint. Nasama ko lang. So basically, ganito yun sa, ano, kung makikita nyo, di ba, sa book ni Zeus, sa, ano, sa PFRS 9 part 2 pages lang si financial liabilities. Maikli lang yan siya. Oh. And as you know, financial liabilities to siya. So, intermediate accounting part 2 to. So, IFRS 9 requires all financial liabilities to be measured at amortized cost. So, general rule, amortized cost siya. Yung in-amortization natin, di ba? As you know, discussion, di ba, sa ano, payables. Kung saan, ninalo natin, di ba? Tawag dito, ina-amortize natin, present value tayo. So the financial liabilities required, yun yung general rule natin, amortized cost. So the financial liabilities required to be measured at FVPL because it is ano, unless the financial liability is required to be measured at fair value through profit or loss kasi held for trading siya. So yung pag held for trading siya, so yung financial liability mo, FVPTL. Anong example niya, sir? Ang example is derivatives, basically. The financial liability, when a transfer of financial asset does not qualify for the recognition or when the continuing involvement of post applies, di ba? And financial liability is a financial guarantee contract. So yun yung mahalaga. General rule, yun ang tanda nyo. General rule, financial liability is amortized cost. Ito lang exception kung kailan hindi amortized cost. So IFRS 9 requires all financial liabilities to be measured at amortized cost unless, ito additional pa, financial liability commits to provide a loan below market interest rate. Meaning, bakit below market interest rate? May liability ka. Kaso kung titingnan mo, yung interest mo sa loan, sa inutang mo, below market interest rate. So, goods yan sa'yo, di ba? Magandang ano yan sa'yo, magandang effect yan sa'yo. Favorable, kumbaga. So, yun, hindi sa amortized cost. Financial liability is a contingent consideration recognized by an acquirer in a business combination to which IFRS 3 applies. Yun, contingent consideration. Ano example na? Like, for example, nagpaplano na kayong ano? Nagpaplano na kayong mag-business combination and as we know, it takes a lot of time to business combine, to combine the business, basically. So, isa sa mga conditions yun doon, provisions ng pinagkasundoan nyo. Like for example, if the acquiree was able to reach or nagkaroon siya ng 10% profit increase, di ba? From the previous, compared to the previous year. Di ba? Napag-usapan yun. Pag si acquiree, nagkaroon ng 10% profit increase as compared to the previous year, then, we will pay additional consideration sa ano namin, additional payment sa acquisition, parang ganun. So yun, contingent consideration. Meron kang dagdag na liability na kailangan bayaran. So, contingent, di ba? The entity elects to measure the financial liability at fair value through profit or loss, which is the fair value option. Examples of financial liabilities that are likely to be classified and measured at amortized cost, yung mga trade payables, non-payables, non-indeless, and bank borrowings. So, in accordance with IFRS 9, financial liabilities are to be measured at profit at fair value through profit or loss if either, ito, derivatives, no? Financial liabilities required to be measured at FVTPL or FVPL, kahit tanggalin yun yung T, FVPL na lang, because it is held for trading, like, saan, derivatives. Don't worry, derivatives, PAPE 7, accounting for business combination plan. Kasi advanced topic talaga yan. The entity elects to measure the financial liability at FVTPL, fair value option. So, examples of ano, financial liabilities that are likely to be classified and measured at fair value through profit or loss. So, may example lang, FVPL. So, derivatives that have been not that have not been designated in a hedging relationship, gaya ng interest swaps, commodity futures and option contracts, foreign exchange futures and option contracts. So, baka nanonosebleed na kayo. Ha, interest swap pa na ito, ha? Third year pa. Third year pa. Huwag mo muna itong problemahin. Convertible note liability, convertible note liabilities that have been designated as FVPL and contingent considerations payable that arises from business combination. So ito naman, pag fair value option, kasi di ba dalawa? Pag fair value option, IFRS permits to designate financial liabilities at FVPL if any of the following apply. If electing the fair value will eliminate or reduce accounting mismatch, di ba? Pag ano, it presents a better, ano, better financial information, di ba? Mas klarong finance, mas klarong presentation. Okay, why not, di ba? Fair value option. If the financial liability is managed and evaluated on a fair value basis with other financial liabilities or financial assets and liabilities in groups, so parang sinama sila, groupings, ito, hybrid contract. A convertible note or a loan with a leverage interest contains an embedded derivative that would otherwise be required to be separated. So yan, baka na nosebleed na kayo. Huwag masyado man nosebleed. G's lang to. So with that, to last option, fair value, last option, or last slide, fair value option. If the entity uses the fair value option, changes in fair value that relates to the change in the entity's credit own credit status are presented in OCI instead of profit or loss. However, if it creates or enlarges an accounting mismatch in profit or loss, then all gains or losses are required to be presented sa P&L. This is not subsequently recycled, to profit or loss when the financial liability is recognized. So basically yan yung gist ng PFRS 9. So pag nanonosebleed lang na kayo, wag muna. Tsaka na. Kaya lang yan, di ba? Madali siyang intindihin, di ba? Ang problema lang, ulitin ko, para kang nang siyang plaka, sir. Paulit-ulit mo sinasabi. Pero, ikaw, kasi totoo naman eh. Madali siyang intindihin. Ang problema, marami kang kailangang intindihin. So, with that, punta tayo sa application of concepts. So, number one, an entity invests in a pool of assets that is managed by an investment house. In accordance with the entity's business model, the investment will be held until it matures in 10 years' time. So, as you know, hold to collect na, yeah? At which date, the entity will collect the principal amount in the investment together with the interest earned. In accordance with the principles of PFRS 9, the entity will most likely measure the investment at, di ba? Hold to collect. Tapos walang sell, ni mention ng word ng sell, wala. And yung contractual cash flow niya is SPPI, di ba? So amortized cost yan. Ito sa number 2, kapatid. An entity plans to purchase a new machine in a few years' time. The cost of the new machine is significant. To address this, the entity invests in debt securities. Debt securities. The entity's investment management strategy is to hold the investment and collect the investment income in the form of the interest. So, hold to collect. However, when opportunity arises, the entity sells the investment in order to realize fair value gain. So, management yan yung management niya ng financial asset. Hold to collect and to sell to realize a fair value gain. Hindi lang basta contingency. Ganyan talaga yung business model niya. The entity reinvests any proceeds from sales until the date of purchase of the new machine. In accordance with the principles of PFRS 9, the entity will most likely classify the investment as a letter C. Letter C. Hindi amortized cost kasi may yung sell yung sell transaction niya significant. FVPL hindi rin kasi klarong-klaro. Hindi siya held for hindi siya held for trading. And favoce election, and as we know, favoce election is only applicable to favoce election is equity securities lang yan. Favoce mandatory sa debt securities yan. And as you can see here, debt securities ang pinag-usapan natin. So measurement, which of the following financial assets which of the following financial assets are measured at fair value through profit or loss? Held FVPL. Held for trading securities. Okay, goods. Designated financial assets. Trade receivables. Ito FVPL. So, DNA. So, yan lang. Yan yung ating discussion for PFRS 9. Now, ito. As I have said kanina, isasama ko dito yung lecture video from the yung portion ng discussion sa PS32 financial instrument presentation para lang magkaroon ng continue flow kasi supporting standard siya ni PFRS 9. Ilalagay ko lang dito. So yun yung next na ipi-play ko. Isasama ko dito which basically ganun sabi ko nanggaling yung sa previous lecture video, isama lang natin dito para maging karoon ng flow, proper flow ng discussion. So, pwede yung skip yun kasi na-discuss naman previously. Isasama ko lang dito para mas magkaroon ng proper understanding ba. Kasi para may flow yung yung topic. Then after that, punta tayo sa IFRS 7, yung Financial Instrument Disclosure. And yun wala pa yung recording kasama yun dito. Isisiksik ko lang sa gitna ni PFRS 9 and PFRS 7 yung discussion sa PS32. So, kasi yung PS32 kasi is presentation. Si IFRS 7 kasi is disclosure. So, presentation muna bago sa disclosure. So, yan na. Ang next video, insert lang natin si PAS 32. Financial Instrument Presentation. Dito tayo ngayon sa Financial Instruments Presentation. Financial Instruments Presentation. Ngayon, PAS 32 tayo. So, gusto ko na magmerienda. So, PS 32. Anong learning objective sa atin dito? Una, state the definition kung ano bang isang financial instrument. Pangalawa, give examples of financial assets and financial liabilities. Pangatlo, differentiate between a financial liability from an equity instrument. And lastly, state the requirements for offsetting financial assets and financial liabilities. Now, ano bang anong labot ni PS 32? Take note, PS 32 complements PFRS 9, financial instruments, and PFRS 7, financial instruments disclosure. Now, ang PFRS 9 and PFRS 7, later pa to sa mga second quarter pa natin siya madi-discuss. Now, sir, if that's the case, why na-separate yung discussion nila? Kasi basically, class, pina-follow natin yung flow of discussion sa book ni Zeus para may uniformity yung ating discussion. Pero no worries, maintindihan pa rin ang PS 32 without even discussing PFRS 9 and PFRS 7 kasi ang pinupunto dito ni PS 32 is yung presentation lang. Kasi dito sa PFRS 9, dyan yung mga in-depth discussion, o baka yung iba sa inyo mabalyo. Pero hindi naman siya ganun kahirap, pero complex yung discussion nito kasi may mga diagram pa yan. And si PFR 7, madali lang to kasi disclosure lang to eh. PS 32, sa kanya, talks about presentation. Presentation lang. Paano siya pinipresent sa financial statements natin. So let's go to the first learning objective. Definition ng isang financial instrument. So, ano nga ba tong isang financial instrument? A financial instrument is any contract that gives rise to a financial asset of one entity and a financial liability or equity of another entity. So let's say may dalawang entity tayo. O ba to? May dalawang entity tayo. Si entity 1 at si entity 2. So ang sabi dito, for entity 1 sa kanya, he will recognize that as a financial asset. Si entity 2, he might recognize that as either financial liability or a financial equity or equity lang. Yeah? So, is any contract that gives rise to a financial asset of one equity and a financial liability or equity instrument, bakit to FE? E, dapat. Parang i-raise natin ito. Or a equity instrument, EI, sa other entity. So, dapat present yan. Dapat present tong ano to eh. Na sa isa, financial asset. Sa isang entity naman, financial liability or equity instrument. To of another entity. So, yan ah. Sila yung dalawa. So, with that, ito mga financial assets. So, yun naman sabi dito eh. Kasi simple lang itong si ano, PS 32. Dito kayo mawiwindang kay PFRS 9. Oo. PS 32, PFR 7, simple lang. Presentation lang kasi ito siya. And ito, disclosure lang. PFRS na yan yung bulk ng discussion. But this dito pala, may idea na kayo anong inano sa PFRS 9, di ba? So, financial assets is any asset that is, yun, cash, an equity instrument of another entity, like yung investment is subject. May example naman later on. Basta ito yung mga financial asset, an equity instrument of another entity, a contractual right to receive cash of another financial asset from another entity. Yeah? A contractual right to exchange financial instruments with another entity under conditions that are potentially favorable. Kasi nga asset to eh. Favorable asset. Kung unfavorable yan, liability yan. A contract that will or may be settled in the entity's own equity instrument and is not classified as the entity's own equity instrument. May mga examples yan para hindi kayo malibog later on. Ito naman, pag financial liability. Ito naman, is any liability that is a contractual obligation to deliver cash or other financial asset to another entity, a contractual obligation to exchange financial assets or financial liabilities with another entity under the conditions that are potentially unfavorable. Ito kasi dito, kita nyo, favorable eh. Potentially favorable, so asset yan. Dito naman, potentially unfavorable, so liability yan. Or a contract that will or may be settled in the entity's own equity instrument and is not classified as the entity's own equity instrument. So yan, mga financial liability yan. Ito naman, equity instrument. Is any, so simple lang, di ba? If you can still remember discussion sa ano, sa FAR, di ba? Ang equity, residual yan sa parate. Di ba? Always yan sa residual ni asset and liability. So, equity instrument is any contract that evidences a residual interest in the assets of an entity after deducting all of its liability. Ganun kasimple si equity instrument. So, ito mga examples sila. So examples ng financial assets, di ba? Ito mga, di ba? Ito yung mga ano, is any asset, cash, equity, ito. Ito na sila. Cash and cash equivalent. Gaya na, cash on hand, cash in bank, short-term money placements, ito yung mga ano, cash equivalents and cash funds. Ito mga receivables, such as accounts, notes, loans and finance receivables, mga financial yan sila. Investment in equity, ito na 'yo. Ito yung sinasabi natin kanina. An equity instrument of another entity. Gaya ng investment in equity or debt instrument of other entities such as held for trading, securities investment subsidiaries. Ito na sila. Sinking fund, yan yung mga examples ng financial assets. Ito naman, hindi mo sila makukunti. Asset to sila, pero hindi sila financial. Asset to sila, pero hindi to, asset to sila. Hindi to sila, ito, gaito, physical assets. Gaya ng inventories, biological assets, PPE, investment. Hindi sila financial, pero asset sila. Intangible, hindi financial pero asset. Prepaid expense and advance suppliers, yun. And the entity's own equity instrument, gaya ng treasury shares, you cannot consider that as a financial asset. Ito naman examples ng mga financial, ito, binabasa na lang natin ito, di ba? Para kasi nga, simple lang itong CPAS 32. O PFRS 9 yung bulk ng financial instruments. Nandun yung in-depth discussion niya. So, examples ng financial liability, ito, mga payables, gaya ng accounts, notes, loans, and bonds, mga lease liabilities, yung mga held for trading liabilities and derivative liabilities, ito, redeemable preference share, yan, di ba? Mention natin ito kanina. Yes, preference share siya, pero hindi siya part ng equity because that is a financial liability. And security deposits and other returnable deposits. Ito naman, mga... Yes, you can consider this as liability sila pero hindi sila financial. Ito, mga unearned revenue, warranty obligation, taxes, SSF, pag-ibig. Ito yung wala ka. Constructive obligation yan. Mga liabilities sila pero hindi sila financial. Ito, talking about the presentation. Pagdating sa financial liability, the entity has a contractual obligation to pay cash or another financial asset or to exchange financial instrument under potentially unfavorable kasi nga financial liability conditions. Ito naman pagdating sa equity instrument, the entity has no obligation to pay cash or another financial asset or to exchange financial instruments under potentially unfavorable. Ito no obligation kasi nga equity siya eh. Ito, siyempre meron kasi that is a liability. Ito, contract settled through equity instrument. So pagdating sa financial liability, binabasa na lang natin to siya eh, kasi this is more on presentation. Walang in-depth discussion to, more on theories of account to. So pagdating sa financial liability, the contract requires the delivery of first a variable number of the entity's own equity instrument in exchange blah blah blah. Basahin niyo na lang to, equity instrument, kasi mas maintindihan niyo to sa pag discuss na niyo na in-depth yung PFRS 9. So PFRS 9, that is tamang pagkakalala ko, intermediate accounting part 2 yan sa equity portion, PFRS 9. Or sa, tama pagkakalala ko. Ito na, redeemable and callable preference share. Ito, magkaiba to sila. Pero yung redeemable na pag-usapan natin kanina, di ba? Kanina pa, financial liability siya. So itong redeemable preference share, these are preferred stocks. O preference shares to sila. Pangalan pa lang eh. Which the holder has the right to redeem at a set date. These are classified as financial liability. Bakit? Because when the holder exercises its rights to redeem, the issuer, the entity yung nag-issue ng ano, ng share na yan, yung company, is mandatorily obligated to pay for the redemption price. Oo. So dito, kaya siya naging financial liability kasi si holder has the right to redeem at a set date. Oo. Has the right to redeem at a set date. Ang kaibahan niya sa callable preference share, tingnan nyo dito. These are preferred shares or preferred stocks which the issuer, yung company na nag-issue, has the right to call at a set date. So, these are classified as equity instrument because, bakit? The right to call is at the discretion of the issuer and therefore has no obligation to pay unless it chooses to call on the shares. So, yan, hindi siya makakonsider as the liability kasi kung makikita nyo dito, favorable ito sa company, sa issuer. Ito, unfavorable, di ba? Kasi redeemable. Wala siyang choice. Oo, basta dumating yung redeemable date, yung set date, required siyang bayaran yan. Oo, required siyang bayaran yan. So, unfavorable yung circumstances na yan, hence it is considered to be as financial liability. On the other hand, itong callable preference share, yung right to call, oo, yung may karapatan dito, si issuer. Oo, yung company. So, favorable sa kanyang conditions. So, yan, equity instrument siya. Ito naman, compound financial instrument. Basically, ang pinag-usapan nito, kinombine yung dalawa. Paano? A compound financial instrument is an instrument, is a financial instrument, I mean, that from the issuer's perspective, sa kanyang point of view kay company, that financial instrument contains both a liability and an equity component. So, ibig sabihin, compound, dalawang nandyan. Liability and equity component. So, parang kung gagawa ka ng pie, ano niya, ganun, oh. Yung isang, pangit ng drawing. Yaw. So, ngayon, no? Oh. So, ito yung sabi natin financial instrument. So, a portion dyan, liability, FL. Another portion is an equity instrument. Yeah? So, yan. Compound financial instrument tawag yan. So, these components are classified and accounted for separately. Paano? As follows. The value assigned to the liability component is its fair value without the equity future. So, is its fair value without the equity future. So, the value assigned to the equity component is yung residual amount. Kasi yung nature ng equity, di ba? Yun yung nature ng equity. Balikan natin. Oh, in any contract that evidences a residual interest. Oh, residual talaga ang nature ni equity. So, in this case, after deducting the value assigned to the liability component from the total fair value of the compound instrument. So, kung yung fair value ng compound instrument is 1 million. Oh, compound instrument, 1 million yung kanyang fair value. Now, separately stated na yung fair value ng liability component without the equity instrument or without the equity future is 700 lang. Oo, without the equity, yung liability ni ano? Ni liability, yung fair value ni liability component without the equity, 700K. So, yung residual niyan, which is 300K, yun yung masasabi yung equity component. Kasi residual amount yung kanyang ano eh. So, ganyan yung pag-separate sa kanila. Ito naman, treasury shares. Treasury shares are an entity's own share that were previously issued but were subsequently reacquired but not retired. Ibig sabihin, hawak-hawak pa rin yan nila. Oo, pwede nangyari yan. So, nangyari yan. Like, pag-issue ka ng share, tapos babawiin mo. Tapos, hindi mo ni-retire, hindi mo kinancel, kumbaga. So, hinahawak mo pa rin. So, treasury shares ang tawag dyan. Now, treasury shares are treated as a deduction from equity kasi yes, they are shares. But they are not outstanding. Oo, hindi sila outstanding. Hindi sila pagmamayari ng third parties. Oo, kasi yung nagmamayari niyan is the company. So, it's nonsense to treat them as part of equity. Kaya yan tinatanggal. Treasury shares, treasury share transactions are recognized directly in equity. Therefore, they do not result to gains or losses. Bakit? Kasi ganito yung nangyari yan eh. Itong equity mo. Equity mo yan. So, pag may nagkakaroon ng transaction sa ano, treasury shares mo, parang nagkakaroon ng reclassification yan. O from one treasury, from one part of the equity to another, parang nagbabaliktaran lang yan sila. So, walang nangyayaring gains or losses kasi within the equity lang. Kaya walang nangyayaring gains or losses kasi within the equity lang yung transactions. Ito naman, interest dividends, losses, and gains. Interest dividends, losses, and gains that relate to financial liability. Pag it relates to financial liability, these are recognized as an income or expenses in profit or loss. Kapag naman equity instrument, those interest dividends, losses, and gains relates to an equity instrument directly in equity. Kasi nga, equity. And lastly, offsetting of financial assets and liabilities. So, nandito yun. So, a financial asset and a financial liability are offset and only the net amount is presented in the financial statements of position when the entity has both. So, may conditions. Kung hindi na satisfy tong conditions na to, you cannot offset a financial asset with a financial liability. You cannot offset. Kapag hindi na satisfy tong dalawang conditions. So, ano yung mga conditions na yun? A legal right of offset, meron ka. And second, an intent the intention to settle the amounts on a net basis or simultaneously. So unless yan, both conditions are present, you cannot offset. Dapat present yan sila para maka-offset ka. So let's go to the application of concepts. So ito. So una, a contract that will be settled. O, financial instruments daw. A contract that will be settled by the entity receiving or delivering a fixed number of its own equity instrument in exchange for a fixed amount of cash or other financial or another financial asset is most likely to be classified by the issuer as equity instrument yan. So balikan yung definition sa previous slide. So that is considered to be an equity instrument. Second, presentation. Which of the following is classified as an equity instrument rather than a financial? So, classified as an equity instrument rather than a financial liability. Una, preference shares that are mandatory redeemable yan, financial liability yan. A contract that is settled by the delivery of a variable number of entities own equity instruments in exchange for fixed amounts of cash or another financial asset. Entities own equity, so financial liability yan. Next, a contract that is settled by the delivery of a fixed number of the entities on equity instrument in exchange for a viable amount of cash or another financial asset. So, balikan natin to dito. Hmm. So, yan, no? Oh, viable, fixed. So, ang answer, shares issued but were subsequently reacquired. Ito. Letter D. So, compound, ano? Compound instruments. Hindi naman ito na-cover, no? Oh, hindi na ko. Oh, 4A. Variable amount. So, ilagay natin sa taas ito ngayon. Punta tayo sa compound instruments. So, entity A issues a convertible bonds with face amount of 2 million for 2,600,000. For 2,600,000, each 1,000 bond, 1,000 peso bond is convertible into 10 shares with par value of 60. On issuance date, the bond are selling at 102,000 or at 102 without the conversion option. So, yun yung fair value ng bond. Bonds are selling at 102 without the conversion option. So, what is the value allocated to the equity component on initial recognition? So, paano ang solve niyan? So, 2 million yung face amount. Tawag dito. 2 million. 206 yung ano, yung compound value niya. Both liability and the equity. So, 2,600,000. So, anong sinabi natin dito kanina? Para malaman yung value nila, si liability component yung fair value without the equity feature. So, yung sarili niya. Tapos, kung anong residual nun, equity component na. Oh, ibabawas mo sa ano eh. So, in this case, 2,600,000 yung combined value ni liability and equity. 2,600,000. So, para malaman natin yung value nilang dalawa, in this case, yung value ng equity component, hanapin mo natin yung value ng liability component, which is face amount of 2 million times mo sa 1.02. 2,040,000. So, yan yung value ng liability component. Oh, kasi oh. On issuance dates, the bonds are selling at 102. So, parang yun yung fair value niya. Oo. 102. So, 2,040,000. Paano nakuha? 2 million times 102. Oh, so, parang times 102%. Parang ganon. So, minus natin. Magkano yan? Minus, it's 560. O yun, 560. Lumabas siya. Yan yung value ng ating liability component. O yeah. Yung total value nila, both liability and equity component, para malaman yung value ni equity, i-deduct mo yung value ni, yung separate value ni liability component. Kasi residual si equity. Yun yung nature niya. Next, treasury shares, interest, dividends, losses, and gains. Which of the following statement is correct? So, entity A acquires its own share for 10,000. The shares will be entity A recognized a gain or loss. Wala kang ano. Kasi within the equity yan eh. So wala kang i-recognize sa gain or loss kasi within the equity lang yan. Gains or losses arising from a financial liability recognized directly in equity. No. Nakalagay dito profit or loss yung recognition. Di ba? O, tiris to. C. Entity A declares dividends. Entity A will recognize the amount of the dividends as expense in profit or loss. Wala. O? Saan yun? No. Sa equity yan eh. Okay. Tapos sa letter D. Entity A settles a liability with a carrying amount of 100,000 for 85,000. The transaction results to a 15,000 gain that is recognized as a profit or loss. So, entity sells liability carrying amount of, oh, yeah, financial liability to. So, recognize mo sa, oh, entity A, settle sa liability with carrying amount of 100,000 for 85,000. So, 100,000 yung utang niya, pero binayaran niya lang ng 85. So, goods for him, di ba? Kasi 100,000 yung utang, pero 85 lang binayad niya. So, this transaction results to a 15,000 gain. And it is recognized in profit or loss kasi liability yan eh. So with that, letter D ang answer. Haluan lang ng analyzation. And lastly, entity A has an accounts receivable of 200,000 from entity B. In addition, entity A has an accounts payable of 160,000 to entity B. So parang baliktad sila, no? Oh, ito na yun dito. Oh, ito na yun. Si A may receivable, ganito lang niya. Si A may receivable kay B. So si B may payable kay A. On the other hand, si A may payable kay B, si B may receivable kay A. So parang nagdoble sila. May two separate transactions na pwedeng ma-offset kasi si A, si B mayroon siyang ano? Oh. Ganito basically yung itsura niyan. So since ganun yung itsura niyan, may chances na pwede silang ma-offset. Pwede yan ma-offset. Pero dapat present yung dalawang conditions. So, basahin natin. So, ito, si entity A may accounts receivable kay B. Si, on the other hand, may accounts payable naman siya kay B. So, baliktad siya. So, circle of life. So, with that, pwedeng may possibility of offsetting. Kasi, may utang ka sa kaibigan mo. Yung kaibigan mo may utang naman sa'yo. So, quits. Parang quits na lang, di ba? If ever. Pero, siyempre, dito sa accounting standard natin, merong kailangan conditions na kailangan masatisfy para ma-allow yung offsetting ng financial asset sa financial liability. Basahin natin. The accounts receivable is due in 30 days. Well, the accounts payable is due in 90 days. Entity A intends to settle. First, the accounts receivable. Tawag dito. If entity A has legal right of if entity A has a legal right of ops or offset of how much accounts receivable will be shown in its statement of financial position. Financial position. So ano magiging answer diyan? Kasi 200,000 yung accounts receivable niya, yan. So ang tanong, how much accounts receivable will be shown in its statement of financial position? So, mababawasan ba itong 200? Magiging 40 lang ba ito siya? Kasi 200 minus 160. So, 40 na lang ba ito siya? Or baka yung 160 lang? Oh, di ba? Ang magiging answer, 200 pa rin. Walang nangyaring offset. Walang nangyaring offset. Bakit? Kasi, ang sabi lang dito, entity A intends to settle first the accounts receivable. So, walang, hindi na-satisfy itong second condition natin. Kasi so, so entity intends to settle kasi hindi satisfy. Intention to settle the amount on a net basis or simultaneously. Wala eh. Kasi ang plano lang ni entity intends to settle first the accounts receivable. Hindi niya, there's no intention kasi you can assume that as a legal right to offset off. Kasi ang accounts receivable niya due in 30 days, accounts payable niya due in 90 days. Ha? Pero wala talagang intention to settle the amount on a net basis. Kasi ang intention lang ni A, accounts receivable lang first. Wala siyang intention to settle net basis ng 200 and 160. So, since walang intention to settle in a net basis, ayaw niyang inet, ayaw niyang i-quits na lang, yeah? Ayaw niyang i-offset, 200,000 pa rin. Walang nangyaring offset. So, yan yung ating discussion for this topic.
Okay, okay, okay. So, if ever man, baka in-skip niyo lang yung PS32 or tawag ito, or kinuntiin niyo yung ano, pag ni-recap niyo, walang problema. Eh, dito tayo ngayon sa ano, sa PFRS 7, which is the Financial Instrument Disclosures. Ngayon, sinasabi ko pa lang na pwede nyo nang i-end yung video. O, tingnan nyo na lang yung PowerPoint nito kasi basically, anong gagawin natin? Babasahin na lang natin to. Itong ano, PFRS 7. Kasi nga, madali lang to siya eh. Disclosure lang kasi to siya eh. Ano yung mga kailangan i-disclose? Hindi kailangan ng masyadong discussion dito or hindi talaga kailangan ng discussion dito kasi disclosures na lang to eh. Parang supporting. Oh, kasi supporting ano na lang to standard ni PFR 7. PS32 and PFR 7 are basically supporting standard of PFR 9 financial instruments. So, kahit i-end yun na yung video ngayon, okay lang. Kasi basically, parang babasahin na lang natin to sila. Itong PFR 7 eh, maikli lang to. So, anong mga learning objectives natin for PFR 7? State the two main categories of disclosure under PFR 7 and pangalawa, state the type of types of risks required by PFR 7 to be disclosed. Kung ano yung mga risks na yun. So, anong objective niya, no? PFR 7? As we have said dito, si PFR 7, it prescribes the disclosure requirement for financial instruments. So, yung nagsabi, bakit anong reason, bakit sineparate nila yung disclosure for financial instruments, bakit nila sinama sa PFR 9? I don't know. Bakit pa kailangan ng separate standard for that? Pero here we are, di ba? PFR 7 describes the disclosure requirements for financial instruments. I think maybe because si PFR 9 kasi hindi yan yung ano, hindi yan yung unang version ng standard ng ano ng financial instrument. Before PFR 9 kasi meron tayong IAS 39 or PAS 39. As you can see, di ba, wala tayong na-discuss na PAS 39 kasi wala, yun yung ano previous number or previous standard number ni financial instruments. But around 2009-2010 na revise yan, no, financial instruments. Tinanggal si IAS 39, pinalitan ni PFR 9. Oh, yun yung bago. So kaya napapansin nyo, bakit mas latest yung standard ni PFR 9? Yeah? Kasi ito, PFR 7 to, supporting standard ng PFR 9, pero bakit siya yung nauna? Diba dapat pina-follow up niya lang to si PFR 9? Kasi nga, si PFR 9, na-revise yan siya. Oh, yung financial instrument standard na-revise, si PFR 9 yung pumalit. Dati IAS 39. Ewan ko kung ano yung before IAS 39, pero yan yung ano predecessor ni PFR 9. Kaya napapansin nyo, di ba? PAS 32, mas matanda pa siya compared kay PFR 9. Sinusuportahan niya lang naman si PFR 9 kasi nga, merong previous standard before PFR 9 in relation to financial instruments. So, the disclosures are broadly classified into the following two main categories. So, una, significance of financial instruments to the entity's financial position and performance. And yung pangalawang ano, classification for disclosures, the nature and extent of risks arising from financial instruments to which the entity is exposed and how the entity manages those risks. So, yung dalawa. So, dito tayo sa una. Yung significance of financial instruments to the entity's FS. So, sa statement of financial position, yung significance niya is yung ang entity required sang to separately disclose the carrying amounts of each of the categories of financial assets and financial liabilities, so separate under PFR 9. Pangalawa, second bullet point, if an entity has reclassified financial assets, it shall disclose the date of reclassification, kung kailan niya reclassify, an explanation of the change in business model, yeah, and the amount reclassified between the categories. And lastly, if an entity has offset financial assets and financial liabilities, it shall disclose the gross amount of those assets and liabilities, the amounts that were set off, and the net amounts presented in the statement of financial position in a description of related legal right of set off. So, yan lang. Ito naman, ito sa financial position, ito sa statement of profit or loss and other comprehensive income, yeah, sa income statement. An entity is required to disclose separately the income, expense, gains, or losses arising from the different classifications. Yeah, sabi ko, pinabasa lang natin kasi maikli at madali na ito si PFR 7 under PFR 9. Other disclosures, the entity shall disclose the fair value of each class of financial assets, And financial liabilities in a way that the fair value can be compared with the carrying amount. So, yan lang. Yan yung sa ano. Ito yung first part sa significance of financial instruments sa FS ni entity. Ito naman yung pangalawa, yung sa risk. So, nature and extent of risk arising from financial instruments. Na itong credit risk, liquidity risk, and market risk. Makikita nyo rin to sa ano, MAS nyo. O, discuss rin to sa MAS. Credit risk, liquidity risk, and market risk. Si, and magkaiba to silang tatlo. Si credit risk, this is the risk that one party to a financial instrument will cause a financial loss for the other party by failing to discharge the obligation. So, meaning ng credit risk, yung risk na baka hindi makabayad ng utang yung may utang. Oh, so kawawa yung may right. Yung may obligation na magbayad ng utang, baka hindi makabayad. So yung may right na makareceive ng utang, credit risk niya. Liquidity risk, ano naman to? This is the risk that an entity will encounter difficulty in meeting obligations associated with financial liabilities. Meaning, papalapit na yung bayaran, yung deadline, yung due ng bayaran ng utang mo, ng liability mo. However, namomblema ka, wala kang pambayad. But it does not necessarily mean na insolvent ka or bankrupt ka. But rather, wala kang mahuhugutan ng pambayad mo. Oo, hindi ka liquid. Paano yan? Eh, kasi may mga instances yan eh. Yes, may asset ka, hindi ka insolvent. However, the problem is, yung mga assets mo, di ba? Napag-usapan natin ito, PPE, o mga non-current asset, yung mga mahirap i-liquidate, mahirap ibenta para makakuha ka ng cash. So yun, di ba? So yun, liquidity risk yun na baka pag dumating na yung bayaran ng utang mo, wala kang maibayad kasi hindi ka liquid. Wala kang maibigay. It does not necessarily mean na bankrupt ka, na insolvent ka. It's just that na ano, wala kang maibigay. Oo. Yun sa liquidity risk. Sa market risk naman, this is the risk that, ano, that the fair value of future cash flows of a financial instruments will fluctuate because of changes in market price. So yun, kaya market risk yung mga fluctuations na nangyayari. Yun sa stock exchange, di ba? Market risk comprises the following three types. So currency risk, that is associated with the fluctuation in foreign exchange rates. Yan, sa derivatives yan, makikita nyo. Interest rate risk, that is associated with changes in market interest rate. Other prices that associated with the risk associated with fluctuations in market prices other than those arising from the interest rate reserve or currency risk. So yan, dalawa, significant sa FS and yung risk. Yan yung pinapertain ni PFR 7. So qualitative and quantitative disclosures on risk, the entity shall provide both the qualitative and quantitative disclosures for each type of risk required by PFR 7 to be disclosed. Yan. With that, punta tayo sa ano, application of concepts. So dito tayo sa una. Na-cover siya. So, PFR 7 addresses which, so number one, PFR 7 addresses which of the following? Una, presentation of FS as financial assets, financial liabilities, or equity instrument. Bakit to? Hindi. The recognition and measurement of financial instruments. Hindi. PFR 7 yan eh. Ito, presentation, ano to? Di ba? PS 32 yan. Itong recognition and measurement, di ba? PFRS 9 yan. Yeah, PFRS 9. Ito na letter C, the disclosures about the significance of financial instruments to the entities FS and performance and the nature and extent of risk arising from financial instruments to which the entity exposed and how the entity managed those risks. So letter C tayo. So hindi din itong all of this. Yeah, PAS 32, PFRS 9, and ito naman PFR 7. Number two tayo, which of the following properly describes credit risk? The possibility the entity will not be able to settle its financial liability when they become due, so liquidity risk to. LR. The possibility that the entity will incur loss on its foreign currency denominated market instruments when there's an adverse change in foreign exchange rate, so market risk to under currency risk, yeah? Market risk to under currency risk. Market risk, currency risk. The possibility that an entity cannot collect on its receivable. So yun, di ba? Credit risk yan. Basahin natin itong letter D. The possibility that an entity will be required to pay higher interest on its variable rate loan when market interest rates increase. So yan, di ba?
market risk din siya, pero under sa interest risk. So, MR, interest RR siya. So, letter C. So, yan lang. Yan lang yung IFRS 7. So, with that, of course, quiz tayo. Schedule lang natin. With that, end tayo ng discussion natin. Bye-bye. Love you.